We're fortunate to have with us one of the most important voices of the growing worldwide effort to learn the truth about the events of 9/11. Among her other contributions, Barbara Honegger is the visionary artist behind both the Boston Tea Party for 9/11 Truth and the Third Beam, which symbolized Building 7 that she organized in New York City on the 9th anniversary of 9/11. And that has become the icon for architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth, as well as the 9/11 Truth movement worldwide. Barbara is also a national whistleblower. She served as White House policy analyst and special assistant for domestic policy in the Reagan-Bush senior administration, where she was the first to resign as a matter of conscience. She then wrote her groundbreaking book, October Surprise, revealing the Iran part of the Iran-Contra scandal. Her book led to a full-scale subpoena-powered investigation, as well as a cover story in Newsweek magazine. Barbara then worked from 2000 to 2011 as senior military affairs journalist at the Naval Postgraduate School, the premier science, technology, and national affairs graduate research university of the Department of Defense. In this position, she had access to the highest level civilian and military officials of the Bush-Cheney administration, helping her to get the real story of the 9/11 Pentagon attack. She published her findings in the Pentagon Attack Papers, which was republished in Jim Marr's best-selling book on 9/11 called The Terror Conspiracy. Professor David Ray Griffin has said of her findings that they would change the discussion of what happened on 9/11. Ms. Honegger has also done pioneering investigative work on the war games exercises taking place on 9/11, as well as the anthrax attacks. She's one of the founding members of Patriots Question 9/11 and a charter member of Political Leaders for 9/11 Truth. Currently, she's completing a book on the Pentagon attack. Please welcome Barbara Honegger.
Thank you so much for coming out. It's a really great turnout. I'm pleased. It's wonderful to be in Seattle. I've never been in Seattle before. I actually saw Mount Rainier with hardly a cloud on it yesterday. And I was told that I would never be able to see Mount Rainier without a cloud, so I considered that a good sign for tonight. The title of my talk is Behind the Smoke Curtain, which I believe will also be the title of my book, which I hope will be out this coming March, in a couple of months. And I'm going to self-publish it, and it will be available on Amazon.com. The alternative title for my talk is, or, everything you think you probably know about the Pentagon attack is wrong. And that would be even for people who have been members of the 9/11 Truth Movement for quite a while. I would be interested to know, show of hands if you're not too shy, how many people have already investigated 9/11 or consider yourselves 9/11 Truth people? Oh, it's about a third of the audience. That's wonderful. So what that means is two-thirds of the audience is here to be informed, and that's also wonderful. I congratulate you. The reason I have this slide up, it's because for those of you who are members of the 9/11 Truth Movement and already believe you know about the Pentagon attack, I wanted to put these next two slides up so that you understand that even though what you're about to hear is not what you think happened at the Pentagon, this presentation, the information in it, has already been seen and reviewed by the world leaders of the 9/11 Truth Movement, who have these rather phenomenal feedback about this presentation. So the bottom line is it's safe to open your mind about what you're about to hear. And here's some more amazing work, truly historic. So, what happened at the Pentagon and didn't, and why it matters so terribly much for our future. 1 year before 9/11, on September 11th, the year 2000, the neocon organization that called themselves Project for a New American Century, or you may have heard the acronym PNAC or PNAC, actually called in one of their publications for a new Pearl Harbor.
This famous quote is from the Project for New American Century Manifesto from page 51. Quote, "The process of transformation, even if it brings revolutionary change, is likely to be a long one, absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor," unquote. As the Project for New American Century Manifesto was being published, this offer was made to producer Aaron Russo a full year before 9/11.
In September of 2000, Nicholas Rockefeller, of the Rockefeller family who built the Twin Towers, told Russo, quote, "There's going to be an event, and out of that event, we're going to invade Afghanistan. So we can run pipelines through the Caspian Sea, so we can go into Iraq, so we can take the oil, so we can establish bases in the Middle East to make the Middle East part of the New World Order." And then he says, "In my relationships with some of these people, the Rockefellers, the Council on Foreign Relations, etc., in my relationships with some of these people, I can tell you that is as evil as it gets." That's Aaron Russo. If he joined them, Russo was told, he would, quote, "be spared the police state measures, the domestic surveillance state measures, that would be imposed on the rest of the American public," that means you, "after," quote, "the event," unquote, happened. This is a year before 9/11. And you can see this statement by Aaron Russo on a video on the net.
The Project for New American Century neocons prepared the ground for 9/11 so it would be seen as a surprise attack, which it wasn't, and for the chorus of Pearl Harbor, Pearl Harbor, New Pearl Harbor on September 11th. In the months leading up to the 9/11 attacks, Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld gave out literally hundreds, if not thousands, of copies of neocon Roberta Wohlstetter's 1962 book on Pearl Harbor, a book which pushed the false surprise attack and intelligence failures official line of the original Pearl Harbor attack. She was the wife of neocon godfather, who was Deputy Secretary of Defense Wolfowitz's personal mentor, Richard Pearl's father-in-law, and Zionist passionate war hawk Albert Wohlstetter. The movie Pearl Harbor hit theaters in late May of 2001 using real Navy ships that were arranged with the Navy by the Navy's man in Hollywood, who was on deck to assure so-called historical accuracy and pyrotechnic special effect.
Only an attack on an iconic national military facility, however, could give them their new Pearl Harbor. Just think about it. Even though on 9/11 the World Trade Center attacks were more spectacular, for sure, and they were the first attacks, the World Trade Center Towers 1 and 2, they would have been likely seen, in my opinion, as just a very much bigger World Trade Center 93 or a much bigger Oklahoma City. But both of those attacks had already been handled by the civilian courts. And these people did not want the 9/11 attacks to be viewed as a bigger Oklahoma City or a bigger World Trade Center 93. They wanted them to be viewed as a new Pearl Harbor, which required an attack on something like the iconic military facility at Pearl Harbor. And that iconic military facility was the Pentagon. Only the Pentagon attack made 9/11 into the new Pearl Harbor that the authors of the PNAC manifesto wanted and needed to roll out their global domination agenda. They needed it to claim justification for endless preemptive wars, which we are still in over 11 years later, for their global domination agenda. And most people don't know, point three, for the creation shortly after 9/11 of the first U.S. mainland combatant command. It's called NORTHCOM. And what that means is, if you recall, that the Bush-Cheney administration very much wanted and said that the entire world, meaning including the mainland United States, your homeland, was now part of the global battlefield. And in order to make it literally a battlefield, they had to, for the first time, create a combatant command over mainland United States called NORTHCOM. It also enabled the new Pearl Harbor attack on the Pentagon, in addition, of course, to the other attacks of 9/11, but it was the key one, is what I'm arguing, enabled the Bush-Cheney administration to bypass the, on 9/11 and before 9/11, there was joint authority over NORAD's response, over the jets that were so late in responding to all of the attacks on 9/11, took an hour and 15 minutes, which was absurd. On and before 9/11, the decisions as to NORAD responses were actually the joint authority of the US President and the Canadian Prime Minister. So once NORTHCOM was created, they separated out the decision-making, the unilateral decision-making authority of the US President over those kinds of responses. Also, of course, the 9/11, and in particular, the Pentagon made it into the new Pearl Harbor, justified, they claimed, their domestic surveillance state that we are still within. And they enabled Bush Jr., President George W. Bush, to continually evoke Article 2 of the Constitution, his so-called commander-in-chief powers, which he did, and members of his administration did, over and over, repeatedly, to justify violation of our Bill of Rights, of U.S. federal law, of international law, and even Nuremberg principles. Bush even said that it was the Pentagon attack that made it war in his mind, and a new Pearl Harbor. In his memoir, which has been published, his book, and in his speeches after his memoir was published, he said that it was after the World Trade Center 1 hit, he thought it was due to it just being a terrible pilot, that is an accident. He said, in print, that when he was told of the second hit, presumably we are told when Andrew Card whispered in his ear, America's under attack, even then he didn't think we were at war, not per se. He said in his memoirs and his speeches after his memoirs were published that it was with the Pentagon attack that he knew we were at war. And you had to be able to sell to the American public and the world that we were at war in order to justify all these horrendous actions in the name of the 9/11 lie.
Bush wrote in his diary on September 11th, quote, "The Pearl Harbor of the 21st century took place today," unquote.
Because the Pentagon attack had, therefore, to succeed, to affect us being at war, to affect the new Pearl Harbor, and to get their global domination agenda and surveillance state, they couldn't rely upon mere hijackers, no matter who they were, even if there were any. They had to control the operation. And in order to control it, they had to execute it, and only pre-placed explosives, both at the World Trade Center, as David Ray Griffin and Richard Gage and Niels Herit and Professor Stephen Jones and many others have proven, is the real story at the World Trade Center, both World Trade Center's towers 1 and 2, with plane approaches and impacts as the mere cover cause, so that it was apparent that the buildings would be apparent that the buildings came down to the uninitiated because of the plane's impacts and the fires. The same, as you will see from this presentation, is true at the Pentagon. That the real story at the Pentagon is pre-placed inside the building explosives with a plane approach and destruction as the cover cause. To get their new Pearl Harbor, the Project for New American Century neocon signatories, in order to be certain that they had to steal the 2000 election. And they did that in Florida, where Bush's brother was governor, Jeb Bush.
A Project for New American Century signatory.
Bush v. Gore was argued by none other than Ted Olson, whose wife Barbara's, we now know, non-existent alleged cell phone calls from the alleged Pentagon plane Flight 77 were the source, the most important source for the claim that the alleged Pentagon plane hijacker story, that there were hijackers on that plane. And without that story, there is zero evidence that Flight 77 even returned east, even if it was Flight 77, as you'll see, that left Dulles Airport to begin with. And the entire official story of the Pentagon attack falls apart. And in case you question that, the cell phone calls of Barbara Olson from Flight 77 have been deemed non-existent, that is now the official position of the FBI in the Massawi trial, of the Pentagon, and of American Airlines. It's per David Ray Griffin. Bush planned on being a, quote, war president, unquote, before he even ran for the office of president. He said so. With Bush's election, the Project for New American Century signatories then became the U.S. government. You will see that in the next slide, which I will not be able to read because it goes on and on in fine print forever, of all the PNAC signatories and participants. There were two levels, signatories and participants, who actually became the United States government. Once in power, however, only the Pentagon attack guaranteed Bush and the Project for New American Century signatory and participants, Bush becoming a war president, and their getting their new Pearl Harbor to roll out their global domination and domestic surveillance state agenda. Now, these are just, if you could read this, and this will be in my book, all of this, but following the theft of the 2000 election, and by the way, Bush v. Gore was decided by the Supreme Court completely unconstitutionally, because the Constitution makes explicitly clear that in the case of a contested presidential election, that the House of Representatives makes the decision, not the Supreme Court. So following the theft of the 2000 election, the Project for New American Century Manifesto signatories and participants literally became the U.S. government, uniquely with the motive, means, opportunity, and access to effect their new Pearl Harbor in the attacks of 9/11. And what you could barely see here are, this is name after name after name of the individuals who were PNAC manifesto signatories and participants, and their absolutely top positions in the federal government once the election was stolen. Only the Pentagon attack enabled We Are at War, which you notice this is from immediately after 9/11. This is the National Security Agency, NSA General Zahner, who was the head of their Signals Intelligence Directorate. And they apparently expected something to happen because they whipped out this We Are at War immediately after the attacks. Zahner was in charge of the NSA unit that surveilled calls to and from, and I put Al-Qaeda in quotes, Al-Qaeda's global communications center in Yemen for a minimum of a year and a half before 9/11. They knew exactly what was coming down. The new Pearl Harbor and war memes were pushed by the mainstream media as the attacks were literally in progress, before either of the towers fell in New York and they were smoking. This is just one example, but there are dozens. As the attacks were unfolding, the BBC in London began playing clips from Pearl Harbor. Tom Brokaw, NBC Today Show, as the attacks were unfolding in New York, said, "There's been a declaration of war by terrorists. This is the most serious attack on the U.S. since Pearl Harbor." Time magazine, in its special September 2001 9/11 issue, said, quote, "What's needed in response to 9/11 is a unifying Pearl Harbor sort of purple American fury, a ruthless indignation that doesn't leak away in just a week or two," unquote. Pearl Harbor was mentioned war was mentioned by the mainstream media. 9/11 was clearly designed using the original Pearl Harbor attacks as its template. So what did the new Pearl Harbor insider script require the appearance of in the actual execution of the attacks of 9/11? They had to appear to be surprise attacks. They had to appear to be kamikaze pilot attacks. With planes this time used as weapons on buildings instead of ships. Both the original Pearl Harbor and 9/11 attacks were in the morning. There needed to be a critical mass of innocent deaths. The next slide after this one is truly chilling. Condoleezza Rice, the National Security Advisor, and Bush both said immediately after the attacks they just couldn't imagine planes having ever been used as weapons in a kamikaze-like attack. Well, she is a historian, and a kamikaze attack triggered U.S. participation in World War II. It is, I simply can't imagine that Condoleezza Rice couldn't imagine. And Condoleezza Rice and Philip Zelikow, who became the executive director of the 911 Commission cover-up inquiry, and I put inquiry in quotes, were members of Bush Senior's A-team when he was president. They had co-published a book. They served on, as I mentioned, Bush Senior's National Security Council together, and Zelikow became her top aide plenipotentiary at the State Department when she moved to the State Department. And Zelikow, not surprisingly, in his own bio, states that he is an expert on creating public myths, you can read that as lies, and maintaining public presumptions about those lies, and call that cover-ups.
He, Zelikow, was effectively the sole author of the 9/11 Commission report. He wrote its detailed outline before this so-called investigation even began, and Zelikow authored the Bush Doctrine for Unilateral Preemptive War under Condoleezza Rice at the State Department.
I also interviewed Richard Clark, who was the so-called counterterrorism czar in the Bush Jr. Cheney White House. I interviewed him when I was at the Naval Postgraduate School, and he told me in an article that was actually, I published it on a DOD website online, that, quote, the White House approved all major exercise scenarios in advance. Now, the White House can only mean the National Security Council.
And or Vice President Cheney.
And the National Security Council was headed by Condoleezza Rice, and the counterterrorism czar was Mr. Clark himself. So what does that mean? I was the original researcher who uncovered the reality of and the importance of as the modus operandi for the planning, execution, and cover-up of the real inside perpetrator attack of 9/11, that at the center of that were military exercises that were taking place on the morning of 9/11 itself that were on hijack scenarios. So what we're saying here is that Richard Clark himself, the White House counterterrorism czar before and on 9/11, told me personally, and I have published it on a DOD website, that he and Condoleezza Rice knew of and pre-approved the hijack scenario exercises taking place before and on 9/11. To succeed, the real inside job 9/11 PSYOP required a critical mass of innocent deaths. Believe it or not, after the World Trade Center attack in 1993 that killed, I believe, 5 people and injured about 1,000, federal agents were heard to say by reporter Stephen Emerson that, quote, there had not been enough deaths this time. After the 1993 World Trade Center attacks, also, most people don't know this, but the World Trade Center tower's roof doors were locked, ordered locked, by official New York City policy. So that on 9/11, it happened, because of that, that the innocent victims above the impact zones were trapped, terrorized, and killed. They had no way to escape,
except to jump.
And even the New York Times published that I believe 105 victims had gotten right up to the door, where in 1993 they were able to go onto the roof, but they were blocked. Also, after the impacts and before the towers fell, dozens of military and civilian helicopters self-dispatched, wonderful people from the military, started flying towards New York City, intending to rescue survivors from the towers, to risk their lives in their helicopters. They were ordered to go to a nearby military base so that they could not respond. On 9/11, 2 World Trade Center tower attacks, 15 minutes apart, of course, ensured the maximum PSYOP, ensured this maximum live audience for the second World Trade Center hit and the towers collapse. After the 9/11 attacks, Paul Wolfowitz, who was a top signatory and participant in the Project for New American Century manifesto, published exactly a year before 9/11, and was Deputy Secretary of Defense on 9/11, immediately under Donald Rumsfeld at the Pentagon, he actually had this to say about the critical mass of deaths in the 9/11 attacks. This is after 9/11 now. He predicted, before the final numbers were in, that the 9/11 attacks would soon be found to have resulted in a, quote, greater number of American deaths than any single day in U.S. history since the Civil War, more than any single day in World War I and World War II. And that Americans would now be willing to sacrifice their lives in great numbers for the cause of defeating terrorism, the so-called global war on terrorism. And quoted Winston Churchill, quote, America is like a great boiler. Once it gets fired up, the energy it generates is enormous. This was then echoed by Newsweek magazine immediately after, quote, more people were killed by the alleged suicide hijackers last week than the number of American soldiers killed in the entire American Revolution or at Antietam, the bloodiest one-day battle of the Civil War, or at Pearl Harbor, or on D-Day. And locking the roof doors ensured that.
Zbigniew Brzezinski stated the number killed on 9/11 for added effect. Quote, it, meaning 9/11, is more murderous even than Pearl Harbor, and the psychological impact is the same, unquote.
But none of any of this would have succeeded without the Pentagon attack. So, proving its official story a lie, as Richard Gage and David Ray Griffin and so many others have proven for the World Trade Center attacks, to prove that the Pentagon attack official story is a lie is so extremely important. So what is the evidence that a 757, which Flight 77, according to the official story, was, did not hit the Pentagon at the alleged impact point, which was in Wedge 1, and I will show you a diagram of the Pentagon in a moment to show you exactly what the official story claims, and did not hit at what the official story says was the alleged impact time of Flight 77, which according to the official story was 9:37 and 46 seconds. So it's almost 9:38. When we prove this, we prove that the official Pentagon story is a lie. First, so what didn't happen at the Pentagon? We're going to go over this very quickly because the meat of my presentation is what I've discovered did happen there. So first, what didn't happen at the Pentagon? Well, what didn't happen at the Pentagon is what the government says happened, is what the 9/11 Commission report says happened, which Professor Griffin has called a 571-page lie, which it is. And the official story at the Pentagon says that Flight 77, a large 757 American Airlines Boeing airliner, hit the Pentagon at column 14, which you see in this photo. And this is actually a photo that was published on the Pentagon's own website. You see their logo up at the left. Immediately after 9/11, at either the first or the second press conference held in the Pentagon itself, right after the attacks. So the official story, which they were able to spin out that quickly, is graphically shown with the overlay of this alleged plane here that impacted on Wedge 1, in Wedge 1 on the west face or west side of the Pentagon. Now, this is a diagram of the Pentagon that shows the rings and the wedges. Now, at the bottom of the graphic, there it's a little bit cut off, but there's a, looks like a fireball, a little graphic of a fireball. That's the alleged impact point. And if you notice, it is to the right or south of the midline. The wedge one that had been upgraded to withstand a terrorist attack, to withstand either a truck bomb or a bomb at the wall or a high-force lateral impact of a plane, specifically upgraded to withstand the kind of terrorist attack that the official story says happened at the Pentagon on 9/11, is only in Wedge 1. And Wedge 1, most people think Wedge 1 is the whole west side. That is not correct. Wedge 1 goes from that center line at the bottom of the graphic around that right-hand corner at the bottom and up to the center line of the next side to the right. So from going back to the bottom of the graphic, from the center line to the left, it's Wedge 2. So Wedge 2 was going to start the upgrading process the day after 9/11, or at most 2 days after 9/11. In fact, the day after 9/11, the Pentagon had pre-announced that they were going to declare that the upgrade to withstand a terrorist attack, a plane impact, or a bomb on the outside of Wedge 1, which includes the official story alleged impact point of Flight 77, was complete, and that they were then going to start upgrading Wedge 2. Most people don't know this, but the Pentagon both had and has its own heliport. And the reason is that the President and the Secretary of Defense and VIPs like to helicopter in and out of the Pentagon. They don't like to go into Reagan Airport or one of the civilian airports and then drive to the Pentagon. They like to go straight to the Pentagon. So the Pentagon has its own heliport. And that heliport on 9/11, or this is actually a photograph, aerial photograph before 9/11, is this square structure out on the lawn, and that's the west face. Now, if you notice, to the left, which is to the north of the heliport, there's that little structure with a smaller structure on top of it, and that's the heliport firehouse with the heliport air traffic controller where he sat on top of the roof in that smaller structure on top of the roof of the firehouse. And that structure is going to become, and the heliport itself is going to become extremely important when we see what did happen at the Pentagon versus what the official story claims happened at the Pentagon. The official story actually states
that a plane came in at an approximate 45-degree angle, and that its wing hit here, and that it went in basically here into the building, versus, as you'll see, because from window to window is 10 feet, according to the Pentagon Building Performance Report. So it's approximately, count the windows, at least 100 feet between the official story says the plane allegedly impacted, and where, as we're going to see, there actually was a plane that was destroyed at the Pentagon,
which was considerably to the left or the north of where the official story claims it happened. So this is a graphic of a Boeing 757 alleged impact per the official story. And you can see how absurd it is. Wingtip to wingtip, 124 feet. And as I mentioned, the window center to window center on the Pentagon is 10 feet. So it's easy to know the distance when you look at these images by just counting the number of windows and multiplying by 10 feet. This is a properly scaled and positioned Boeing 757, actually positioned in, of course, it's an overlay, but it's positioned the way the official story claims that Flight 77 came in, which shows the complete and total absurdity of it. As you'll see, would be impossible for the official story to be true, because the Pentagon Building Performance Report states that 90 to 95% of the internal damage, which was alleged by the official story to be from the plane somehow getting through the wall, and we will address that in a moment, that couldn't have happened either, but if it got through the wall and it went in and created what they called the internal penetration path of damage, that damage was 90 to 95% on the ground floor. Well, the ground floor is 12 feet high. And they said that 5 to 10% max was on the second floor. Well, it's impossible. And this is why it's impossible. First off, the 757's massive 6-ton steel and titanium alloy engines extend 9 feet beneath its wings. It would have gouged the lawn if it came in anything like at the height of the official story. And there it is again to show you these huge engines way down beneath the bottom of the plane. So based on the interior damage, which was 90 to 95% on the ground floor, the Pentagon's own building performance report found that, quote, the top of the fuselage or body of the plane was no more than 20 feet above the ground, no more. But a 757's body is almost 12 and a half feet in diameter, leaving less than 8 feet between the bottom of the ground. And yet the engines themselves extend 9 feet below. The official story is physically impossible. And, of course, it didn't happen. If the official story were true, those huge engines would have gouged the lawn like this. And it's very important that the official story claims that the plane came in effectively level, not at an angle, which would have avoided this. Instead, the lawn outside the official story alleged impact point, and this is a very famous photograph that almost everyone in the 9/11 truth movement has wrongly used as evidence that no plane was destroyed at the Pentagon. This is outside the official story alleged impact point to the right or south of that midline of the west wall. And there is no gouge on the lawn, and it's pristine, and there's no airplane debris. And for this reason, many people in the 9/11 Truth Movement used this photograph and others like it to allegedly prove that there was no plane that was destroyed at the Pentagon, but that's not correct. However, as you'll now see, there is wreckage and a huge amount of it just further to the left or north at and around the heliport, which you've now seen, outside the wall's center point and to the north or left of that, outside of Wedge 2, which wasn't yet upgraded. So this is just to remind you again that you're going to see the damage that I'm about to show you the photographs of is just to the right of that little fire, the firehouse building with the heliport air traffic controls lookout above it. And that's what you're about to see. That's just one example. The lawn off Wedge 2 is anything but pristine. The Pentagon firehouse in this photograph, you can see the top of the firehouse just beyond that fire engine. And that's that firehouse that you saw in the previous photograph. Two heliport firefighters who were on duty in that little firehouse that morning of 9/11, because most people don't know this, President Bush, before the attacks, was pre-scheduled to arrive by helicopter at the Pentagon heliport around noon, between noon and 12:30. So they were getting ready for that, and he had, just before what I'm about to show you happened, the firefighter Alan Wallace had backed that fire truck out of the firehouse and parked it with its back to the wall, perpendicular to the wall. All of this is to the left or the north of the line demarcating Wedge 1 to Wedge 2. So considerably north, between 120 and 150 feet north of where the official story says Flight 77, as you will see, didn't even come close to the building for another 5 minutes and 16 seconds, as we'll see. And here's the, we're getting into the proof of the timing. On the left in this photograph is the clock from that heliport firehouse. It was stopped by some violent event at 9:32 and 30 seconds. And guess what? That clock has been preserved, stopped at that very time in the Smithsonian Institution's official 9/11 exhibit, which you see here. The clock is the on the flat table. It's the third object from the left, just to the left of Ted Olson's phone, in which he allegedly received calls from his wife Barbara from the Pentagon plane, which the Pentagon, the FBI, and American Airlines all say that it's a lie that that phone was ever used to talk to his wife. So the burning question before us, and this was the question I asked myself over this past year, what violent event, because it had to be a violent event of some kind, at or near the heliport, where heliport firefighter Alan Wallace had just backed one of the heliport fire trucks out in preparation for President Bush's expected arrival. What was it that stopped the heliport firehouse clock at 9:32 and 30 seconds? Especially when the official story claims that Flight 77 was miles and miles still outside of Washington, D.C., and wouldn't even approach the building for 5 minutes and 16 more seconds at almost 9:38, technically at 9:37 and 46 seconds. What stopped the heliport clock? Multiple witnesses state that at 9:32 and 30 seconds, now they don't give the time, you infer that from the combination of the converging evidence of the witnesses' testimony that I'm giving you now and the stop clock of the heliport. Multiple witnesses, including those two firefighters from the heliport firehouse itself, state that a white low-flying plane, and if it's a white plane, it cannot be any American Airlines civilian airliner, which are polished aluminum, so they're silvery. They're definitely not seen as white. But all these witnesses were very clear that it was a white low-flying plane approached the Pentagon on a south path. In other words, south of that center line, to the right of that center line, coming in at a diagonal, south of Navy Annex path, and hit, dragged, or scraped, as you'll see they used those different words, but for the same event, hit, dragged, scraped its left wing at or near the helipad, just before bursting into an immense fireball. And as I mentioned, as American Airlines bodies are polished silvery aluminum, this plane simply could not have been Flight 77, an American Airlines polished aluminum body. Witness Jim Sutherland saw a white twin-engine plane with multicolored horizontal stripes flying an estimated 50 feet, he believed, above I-395 in an almost straight line approach towards the building on a south path. Pentagon Heliport firefighters, as we've already seen, their names are Alan Wallace and Mark Skipper, are direct witnesses to a white plane approaching the heliport and exploding into a massive fireball near the firehouse, which would have killed them had they not noticed it at the last second and literally run. One of them, Alan Wallace, ran away as he saw it coming in. He thought maybe 200 and 250 feet from him, which is difficult to estimate because it's coming right at him, to his left. As he walked with his back out from behind by that fire truck, he was very clear that he looked to his left, which was to the south, and it was coming right at him at that diagonal angle. And it would have killed him had he not immediately run out of the way to save his life and rolled under a van that was, you'll see that van in a moment, that was parked outside the wall of the heliport firehouse. And Mark Skipper, the other firefighter, ran out onto the lawn to the north or to the left and literally leapt away. And they did survive. They were burned, but they survived. I believe, though this is an inference, he did state explicitly that he believed, Alan Wallace, that the plane, which was coming in at an angle, so he saw the right side of the plane on his left, that there was two stripes down the side. He thought they were orange and blue, but they were almost certainly orange, red, or red and blue in order to simulate an American airliner. To avoid being hit by this white plane, heliport firefighter Alan Wallace ran toward the outer wall of the heliport and leapt for cover under a van. And this is his published testimony. After coming out, immediately after, he said, quote, "Everything is on fire. The grass is on fire. The building is on fire. The firehouse is on fire. There was fire everywhere. Areas of the black top, meaning the helipad, were on fire. There was debris everywhere. The trees were on fire." The back end of the fire truck that he and Mark Skipper had just parked facing away from the Pentagon wall was also in flames. Inside the firehouse, the ceiling had crumbled temporarily, trapping the third firefighter, Dennis Young, and was filled also with debris. The official Pentagon report called Pentagon 9/11 actually states that the fireball may have even gone into the still open firehouse door out of which Wallace had just backed out the fire truck or moved the fire truck out. Multiple witnesses saw the planes, this white plane's left wing hit, scrape, or drag on the helipad just before it burst into a fireball. These are just some of the testimonies. Quote, "The left wing of the plane touched the ground by the helicopter pad. The left wing dipped and scraped the helicopter area. The left wing touched the helipad." These are all separate witnesses. "The plane dragged its left wing along the ground. It looked like it hit the helicopter pad, then skipped up. The plane caught an edge of its left wing on the ground. There is a helicopter pad right in front of the side of the Pentagon. The left wing touched there." After the fireball, there was suddenly what one witness called literally millions of small pieces of debris, which I think that the evidence shows is this wreckage of this plane, pieces at and around the Pentagon heliport. Now, this is anything but a pristine lawn. This is also well to the north, between 120 and 150 feet north or to the left of the alleged impact point of Flight 77, further south. The debris, according to witnesses, also rained onto I-27, which is to the right, perpendicular to the wall, out, with some even, according to witnesses, falling on the north side of the Pentagon and on the Fort Myer walking trail. This is completely different from the official account. One of the witnesses, Penny Eglis, claimed that she also saw a white, she was very certain, white, low-flying, south-approaching plane, the above piece from which, she said, actually fell through her car's sunroof. The inside surface of this piece of evidence is dark red, which is nothing at all like the light green on the inner surface of the body of civilian airliners like American Airlines 757s. It looks like a kind of graphite material, which may actually be similar or identical to the material used to stealth military planes. Former NSA, National Security Agency, and military electronics expert Dennis Cimino has told me that he believes this piece is from the wing or stabilizer of a fiberglass drone that was shaped and painted to simulate an American Airlines plane, and that the fiberglass would shatter upon impact into these many pieces that you actually see. Here's another photograph, firemen walking off the edge of the helipad towards the Pentagon wall. Some of the witnesses actually referred to this debris wreckage as like confetti. There were some large pieces, however. Workers walking over the wreckage between the helipad and the Pentagon wall. The closer you get to the wall, the more of this wreckage debris there is. This is a very important photograph. It's looking south towards the Earings collapse zone. So you can see where the wall has collapsed over the alleged impact point of Flight 77, much further south. And the Pentagon firehouse is then to the left off the edge of the photo. So you're looking at something in the middle now between the firehouse on the left and the alleged impact point of Flight 77 on the right. And if it's not too difficult to see where the pristine lawn begins. So the pristine lawn, you saw in that earlier photograph that members of the 9/11 truth movement have been for 10 years or more citing as proof that there was no plane destruction at the Pentagon, is way off to the south. And all of this destruction that they don't show you for whatever reason, inadvertent or otherwise, is further north. And here's more confetti-like wreckage in the distance beyond this large piece. There are some large pieces, which itself is right next to the helipad. And this is incredible. When I discovered this past year, it was quite a shock. There was not just a white plane that came in on a south path, a diagonal south path, at 9:32 and 30 seconds and was destroyed there in some way without, I believe, hitting the wall, because there is no evidence that it actually hit the wall. It was somehow destroyed, and we're about to see how I believe it was destroyed without hitting the wall a split second later. There was not just a white plane there. At the helipad, there was also a helicopter, a military helicopter, at the helipad. It had arrived at the helipad 4 minutes and 42 seconds just before this white plane flew in and exploded in a fireball. And this is amazing. Lifted off only 3 seconds before the white plane exploded exactly there. And how do we know that? We know that from this record. This is the record from the Reagan National Airport for the MC, and that, I believe, stands for a Marine Corps MC helicopter at the Pentagon heliport, showing its arrival, and because this was by radar from Reagan Airport, the arrival meant it had descended below the radar floor, which was about 100 feet, and that was at 9:27 and 51 seconds, and it then returned above 100 feet to radar visibility at 9:32 and 33 seconds. And we saw that the Pentagon clock, the Pentagon heliport clock, firehouse clock, was stopped only 3 seconds before that, at 9:32 and 30 seconds. So I believe, although it is an inference, that that helicopter somehow destroyed that plane.
As we will see in more detail at the end of this presentation, where we get into the evidence for who planned and oversaw the real insider plot of 9/11, I do not believe it is a mere coincidence that the defense contractor company of the Pentagon's own chief financial officer on 9/11, Dov Zakheim, was the manufacturer of a special proprietary system for remote controlling drone aircraft and for destroying drones that were used in military exercises at the terminal phase of those exercises.
The near simultaneity of the helicopter liftoff, within seconds, literally, it had to take a few seconds to get up so that it would avoid being hit by the plane itself, and then could have destroyed the plane by a missile.
Or by an onboard system like that designed by Pentagon comptroller Dov Zakheim's company for destroying military exercise drones in their terminal phase, that is, in this case, just before the drone at the Pentagon on 9/11 would have otherwise hit the wall.
That's speculation, but the plane was then destroyed.
but it is more than telling that System Planning Corporation, or SPC, designs, manufactures, and distributes highly sophisticated technology that enables an operator to fly by remote control as many as 8 different airborne vehicles at the same time from one position either on the ground or airborne. System Planning Corporation markets the technology to take over the controls of an airborne vehicle already in flight. For example, the flight termination system technology could hijack hijackers and bring the plane down safely. The flight termination system can be used in conjunction with the CTS technology that can control up to 8 airborne vehicles simultaneously. The possibility of nefarious use of these brilliant technologies developed and deployed by Systems Planning Corporation certainly deserves careful consideration in any full and impartial investigation of what actually took place on 9/11.
And the helicopter then did lift off. It was not destroyed. In fact, naval historian John Sherwood told Pentagon eyewitness Jeffrey Mark Parsons, an extremely important Pentagon witness, that a helicopter had been sent to the Pentagon, quote, by the White House itself, which would almost certainly, if true, mean that it was sent by either Vice President Cheney or the Secret Service. Quote, this is still from the naval historian John Sherwood, quote, to prevent the plane from going into the Pentagon. Well, if he was referring to that white plane that exploded into a fireball at 9:32 and 30 seconds, stopping the Pentagon heliport clock at 9:32 and 30 seconds, then it certainly was prevented from going into the Pentagon because there is no evidence that it hit the wall just beyond the heliport. Witness Jeffrey Parsons himself, from the 17th floor of his hotel, which was across I-395, he saw a helicopter flying erratically between his hotel and the helipad, going back and forth like a bumblebee. And then it disappeared from his perspective below the Pentagon roof, where it, he says, it would have landed at the helipad. And then he said only a few minutes later, he first left the window. After he had left the window and seen this erratic helicopter, he then heard a massive explosion, went back to the window, saw this big fireball, but he didn't actually see an impact, but he saw the fireball and smoke afterwards. He himself was a helicopter pilot with the U.S. Border Patrol, so he knows what's unusual for a helicopter to be doing, and he says that was extremely unusual, and he didn't understand what it was doing. Air Force witness to CNN's Chris Plant. Quote, I was told by one witness, Plant said, this is on air, live that morning from the Pentagon, an Air Force senior enlisted man, that he was outside the Pentagon when it occurred. He said that he saw a helicopter circling the building, the Pentagon. He said it appeared to be a U.S. military, I believe that is the MC or Marine Corps helicopter that we saw the radar record from, and that helicopter disappeared behind the building where the helicopter landing zone, meaning the heliport, is. And then the witness saw a fireball go into the sky, exactly like the heliport firefighters say. This helicopter disappeared behind the building, and then there was an explosion. The near simultaneity of the liftoff of the helicopter and the explosion explains why this witness and many others, whose vantage points only allowed them to see the helicopter and not also the plane come in, like the heliport firefighters, led to erroneous early reports that the Pentagon had actually been attacked by a helicopter. In fact, Vice President Cheney said that himself to Reuters. And all this happened at 9:32 and 30 seconds, which is more than 5 minutes, 5 minutes and 16 seconds before the official story says Flight 77 was anywhere close to Washington, D.C. So, for those of you who are 9/11 truth aficionados, I'm going to answer this question I'm always asked. Well, what about the Citizens Investigation Team, or CIT, Northside witnesses? I honor those witnesses. I, however, do not believe that the interpretation of what the witnesses said by the Citizens Investigation Team is correct. I think it is very incorrect. Why? As there is no evidence of any plane destruction other than the white plane that exploded near the heliport at 9:32 and 30 seconds, if the plane that a dozen or so witnesses saw approach to the north of the center line, to the north of the Citgo gas station, which is on that center line, and to the north of the Navy Annex, which is on that center line. If that plane flew over, which many 9/11 researchers believe, falsely believe, it cannot be the white plane, which was destroyed. It didn't fly over the building. It was destroyed if it was the white plane. So it would have to have been either a different second plane, or the white plane could have come around twice. As these North Side witnesses, who were interviewed by the Citizens Investigation Team, however, themselves did not believe that plane that they saw flew over. They believed it did hit because they heard this huge explosion just after seeing it. And given their experiences, the plane that they saw coming in on what's called a north path either approached, would have to have approached near simultaneously with the white plane. Basically, two planes coming in from different directions at the same time, effectively. And the plane that the SIT witnesses, that SIT claims went through the fireball, would have gone through the fireball of the white plane being destroyed near the heliport. Or the plane that the North Side witnesses saw could have been the official story plane that the official story claims came in at 9:37 and 46 seconds. In which case, though, if for the SIT interpretation to be true, there would have to have been a second explosion, which was in fact reported by many witnesses at the Pentagon, as it flew through, however, a pre-existing smoke cloud.
We just heard another loud explosion down at the Pentagon building just seconds ago.
That's our Audrey Barnes, who is standing nearby the Pentagon, saying they heard a second explosion. Audrey, did you see anything since these other attacks have been aerial? Did you see anything flying overhead just before this explosion?
We can't see exactly where the source of the explosion was, but you could hear it very clearly with a loud boom.
Now that's just for 9/11 aficionados. Now back to what the official story says happened but did not. Further south, as we've seen, at least 120 to 150 feet further south along the west wall, more than 5 minutes after all this had already happened. This is again the official story lie from the Pentagon's own press conference right after the attacks. Now, this is further proof that the official story simply cannot be true. Immediately adjacent to the official story alleged impact point, to the right or south of that midline, way south of the heliport, the official story says that Flight 77, a large Boeing 757, hit at effectively ground level, 90 to 95% of the damage in the ground floor, which is only 12 feet tall, to the ceiling, at column 14. So where you see the large circle of the fuselage is centered on column 14. And just to the right, you can see the columns numbered 15, 16, 17, 18, off to the right or to the south. Well, you will notice that where the right engine, that smaller circle is over what's left of an external column that is bowed out, as are all of them. They're not bowed in as they would be if impacted from a massive object from the outside, especially a, you know, 6-ton titanium and steel engine, which they didn't find at the Pentagon, by the way, at all. Some official spokesman actually claimed it was vaporized, which is absurd. So it's impossible. These columns are bowed out to the right of the alleged impact point of the center line of the fuselage of the alleged Flight 77 impact. And then there were also these large spools that were in front. And these spools are 6 feet high, and they were not bowed over right in front of where they claim that the plane hit. And then this is a photograph to the left of the alleged impact point, which is at that red dot. And it's a little bit more difficult to see in this, but the, what's remaining of the columns on the outer columns of the west wedge are actually bowed out also to the left of where the official story says the center nose of the fuselage hit. Okay. And then also a ground effect. This is all the evidence that the official story, in addition to what I've uncovered is what actually did happen, that the official story did not happen as the government says it did. The ground effect makes a 757 impact into the first floor effectively level, the official story says, speed aerodynamically impossible. It is physically impossible. Under these conditions, the plane could not get closer, according to pilots and aerodynamic experts, to the ground any closer than one wing length for approximately 56 feet, which would put it between about what you see here, the fourth and fifth floors up. And yet the official Pentagon building performance report said 90 to 95% of the damage was in the ground floor, which is only 12 feet to the ceiling. And this is a graphic representation of the ground effect because of these high pressure vortices that happen under the wings as it approaches the ground at high speed. The official story trajectory at the claimed speed is thus impossible. Now, these are quotes from Air Force and commercial airline pilot Russ Wittenberg. It is totally impossible, the official story. A 757 could not possibly have been flown at those speeds without going into a high-speed stall to begin with. The airplane won't go that fast when you start pulling those high G maneuvers. That plane would have fallen out of the sky at what the official story claims. And certified Navy Top Gun pilot Ralph Kolstad, whom I have interviewed, with over 26,000 flight hours, including 6,000 in Boeing 757s, like American Airlines Flight 77 was, including the physical plane that flew its Flight 77 allegedly that day. He states, I could not have flown it the way the official story flight path was described. I was a Navy fighter pilot and an air combat instructor and have experience flying at low altitude, high speed aircraft. In other words, exactly what the official story claims. I could not have done what these alleged beginner hijackers allegedly did. Something about the official story stinks to high heaven. Now, the official story also claims that Flight 77, a large Boeing 757, coming in very low at approximately 540 to 560 miles per hour, hit five light poles in a row, there they are, without exploding. But a 757 could not have hit one light pole, according to an expert I'm about to quote for you, let alone five in a row, and even made it to the wall without exploding. Why? Because the official story means that a 757, Flight 77 or otherwise, would had to have had still 11,250 gallons of flammable jet fuel in its wing tanks. Most people don't know, I certainly didn't until I did this research, that the largest, two of the large, almost as large as the center fuselage tank. This is a graphic from Boeing's own website of its 757 200 series, which is what Flight 77 was. And this is flammable material, the jet fuel that is located in the two wing tanks, including tanks off to the way tips. And experts have told me, including Ralph Kolstad, who flew this very plane, he was very clear that the fuel in the center or fuselage body tank is used up first. And the official story says that Flight 77 or A-757 went out and turned around and came back. And before it hit the Pentagon, it was only out for an hour and 17 minutes. And it would have used the fuel from the center fuselage tank. And the tanks in the wings would have been flying fuel bombs. And the official story says that the leading edge of those two wings that are filled with still with fuel, according to the official story, hit five 240-pound light poles like this in a row. When the impact, I found this wonderful image of a single flying bird does this to a wing. And here's an example of what a single flying goose does to the lightweight carbon fiber nose of a plane. And as I mentioned, I interviewed Ralph Kolstad, the Top Gun Navy pilot who flew the physical plane that was Flight 77 on 9/11. He said, if a 757 hit a light pole going at that high speed, it would rip open the wing, rip open the fuel tank in the wing. That wing would erupt into flames. The wings and probably the entire plane with it would have been destroyed before it could ever get to the building. When a leading edge of a wing of this jet hit just a single light pole, it sheared the wing entirely off, spilled jet fuel and wreckage over 100 feet, and crashed the plane to the ground. When the same thing happened to a large airliner, now that plane was smaller than a 757, but when the same kind of thing happened to a large airliner like Flight 77, which was in Detroit in 1987, 18 feet sheared off the left wing, which is the one that hit the light pole, when it hit two light poles, going at only 222 miles per hour, which was less than half the reported 540 to 560 miles per hour that Flight 77 was allegedly going when it allegedly hit five light poles in a row.
And no wings or large wing pieces like this were found anywhere at or in the Pentagon.
And even if Flight 77 or any large airliner had gotten through the light pole and tall 6-foot-high spools obstacle course, a plane couldn't have penetrated, I do not believe, the evidence shows, the newly hardened outer wall of the Pentagon. Wedge 1's outer wall, which you see a graphic to the right from the Pentagon Building Performance Report, how the wall had been hardened after the Oklahoma City bombings. The Pentagon decided that they wanted to harden all of its outer walls to prevent that kind of an attack on the Pentagon. And Wedge 1's outer wall, which includes where the official story says Flight 77 allegedly hit, had just been newly hardened to withstand terrorist attacks, specifically the kind that the official story says happened on 9/11. Now, this very much parallels, doesn't it, the World Trade Centers? Because we know that the World Trade Center Towers 1 and 2 were specifically designed to withstand the impact of a plane like the official story says hit those buildings on 9/11. Same thing with the Pentagon, in just that wedge. Interesting, isn't it? 2 feet thick after the upgrade, steel and Kevlar mesh. So the entire wall was like a huge bomb and plane-proof vest. This is what happened to the nose of a large airliner when it hit a non-reinforced wall. Unlike the hardened wall of the Pentagon on 9/11, far thinner than the Pentagon's wall, going at a mere fraction of the speed, I believe it was 88 miles per hour, claimed for Flight 77. To summarize this part, the official story at the Pentagon on 9/11 claims that after striking five light poles in a row, the leading edge of the wings, and somehow making it through the newly hardened wall that was specifically re-engineered to withstand just such a terrorist attack as at the World Trade Center, without its full wing fuel tanks exploding, which Ralph Kolstad said would have happened, a 757, according to the official story, then finally did explode, but only after it was almost entirely inside the building. And that, this is the official story now, that once inside the building, after being progressively shredded and dispersed over 285 feet, going in at a diagonal 45-degree angle, that it turned into a quasi-liquid, unexploded fuel and debris slurry, and that that slurry somehow magically reconstituted itself after going around all of these still-standing columns into a perfectly focused cone of energy, which somehow magically cut this almost perfectly round alleged exit hole in the C-ring wall. Despite there being, according to Duane Dietz, former NASA Director of Research Engineering, did an analysis of this slide from the Pentagon Building Performance Report, he has shown that there isn't a single path between the official story alleged entrance point or impact point of Flight 77 and the alleged exit hole in the C-ring that does not have multiple still standing columns in the way that would have dispersed this alleged quasi-liquid slurry. Then, according to the official story, somehow made it through the five standing light poles without exploding the wing tanks, somehow made it through this hardened wall like a huge Kevlar vest, somehow made it into the building before some of the fuel exploding, and then this magical slurry reconstituting itself around all of these still standing columns. And then after all of that, the official story actually alleges, and this is from the Pentagon Building Performance Report again, that, believe it or not, 30 Flight 77 passenger bodies and remains were found beyond the C-ring exit hole. in the AE drive between the C and the B ring, the B ring being further in towards the center than even the C ring. And by an amazing coincidence, this is a side note, but I think an important one because it talks to the passengers. By an amazing coincidence, in the Pentagon rubble, the official story claims that there just happened to have been found five unidentified body remains that the government presumes were the hijackers. But that happens to be the very same number, five, that the government claims were unidentifiable remains that it assumes are not the hijackers, which, just to be sure that no one could ever be sure that they were one and the same, they reincinerated and dumped into a landfill. According to the Pentagon's own spokesman, there weren't any victims, however, or any plane parts outside the C-Ring exit hole at all. Terry Mitchell of the Office of Assistant Secretary of Defense for Public Affairs Audiovisual Division, who was given immediate access, he was an insider, to the AE drive to take the Pentagon's own official photos, answered media questions about a photo of the C-ring hole that he showed at the September 15th Pentagon's own press briefing, press conference. And he stated this for the official record, quote, "There is a hole." Yes, he was asked about this alleged exit hole. He said, yes, there's a hole in the C-ring. They suspect, he doesn't say who they are, they suspect that this was where part of the aircraft came through. Although, personally, he was physically there. He says, I didn't see any evidence of an aircraft down there. This pile outside the hole, he said, is all Pentagon metal. None of that is from aircraft whatsoever. This is Pentagon's own spokesman. As you can see, he continues, they've punched a hole in here. This was punched out for the rescue workers to clean out the debris. And here you see the hole again, and it's a little bit difficult to see, but to the left of that hole is an upside down A with a cross across it, and the words punch out. And they were added after the hole was made, by the way. Well, guess what? The inverted A is the International Personal Rescue System symbol for dead victim removed. This hole was made for the exit of Pentagon personnel and the entry of rescue and cleanup teams, just as he said. And it was made, according to shape charge explosive expert and mechanical engineer, PhD Michael Meyer, it was made with shape charge explosives, not by a plane or any part of a plane or any magical quasi-liquid slurry of a plane. According to shape charge expert Michael Meyer, quote, this so-called exit hole is the signature of a shape charge explosive, not of a plane impact or any part of it. It is physically impossible, he said, for the C-ring wall to have failed in a neat clean circle like that, except by shape charge explosives. And in addition, the alleged plane exit hole, which is at the point of the arrow, so where the arrow begins in the upper right is the, you can see that the, that's, but this aerial photograph was taken after the collapse over the alleged impact point, according to the official story, came in at that diagonal, about 45 degree angle, and according to the official story, poked its nose or some part of the plane out of that, at the point of the arrow on the inside of the C-ring. That's the official story. But guess what? I found this graphic from the Washington Post immediately after 9/11. That hole, alleged exit hole, is actually shown in the Pentagon's own data as one of three exit holes in this legend. It's a little bit hard to see, but it says exit holes, third up from the bottom of the legend, exit holes, plural. And then to on the graphic itself, the actual holes are labeled with little orange dots, 1, 2, and 3, and those perfectly match with these three exit holes on the inside of the C-ring. Now, evidently, my pointing this out, which I've been doing for a number of years now, worried some insiders because an alleged 9/11 truth researcher, I won't say which one, has now on his website put out this doctored diagram where he has changed the original Washington Post graphic to say that there's only a single plane exit hole. So the elephant in the room one of the big elephants in the room, not the only one, proving that the official story at the Pentagon is false, again, is time. Because we remember that the Pentagon heliport firehouse clock was stopped by the violent event there at 9:32 and 30 seconds versus the official story alleged impact time of Flight 77 of 5 minutes and 16 seconds later at almost 9:38. The official story is not only wrong, in addition, about the time of the Pentagon attack, which it claims was 9:37 and 46 seconds, but is hiding the real time of the attack for obvious reasons. Interestingly, after the attack, the Army did not know the time. The Army itself was trying to figure out when its building was attacked, let alone how. And so they asked seismologists to check the five closest seismic readout stations for any indication of the time of impact, as had been done for the World Trade Center towers, and Pennsylvania for that matter. And guess what? They found no above-noise seismic signal at all for the official Pentagon alleged impact time. None. Zero. There was no impact signal at the Flight 77 alleged impact time at all. And yet, according to Dave Gapp, who is a top Air Force pilot and crash investigator for over 30 years, quote, if a 757 had struck anywhere near ground level at the Pentagon, there definitely would have been a seismic signal. Air Force Lieutenant Colonel Dave Gapp, retired, 30-year veteran, senior aircraft crash investigator, and who was chief of master air attack planning for both the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. Now, this is one of the frames from the famous five frames that were taken from one of the two Pentagon security cameras outside the West Wall. And if you'll note that on the bottom left of this famous, one of the famous five frames, is September 12th, not September 11th. And if you'll notice, the time is 5:37 p.m. All right? Well, the Pentagon claims in its report in Pentagon 9/11, the Pentagon claims that this is the date and time that these frames were downloaded after the attacks. That's how they explain that it's September 12th. If so, however, because all security cameras have digital time records or they would be useless, if so, the original date and timestamps have been removed before they were made public. So the time of whatever caused the fireball, this famous photograph that was leaked in the spring of 2002 and was on the cover of every newspaper in the world as alleged proof that a plane hit the Pentagon, which it does not. The time of whatever caused that fireball is being actively hidden by the Pentagon and the FBI. It is obviously not at the official story alleged time of 9:37 and 46 seconds. Also, that one five frames video, there were actually two, but those two almost identical videos from two cameras close to each other in the Pentagon, outside the Pentagon West Wall, happens to be, we now know, the only one at the time of this report that I'm about to read you, and now we know since the Massawi trial in 2005, I believe it was, is only one of two of all the 85 videos that the FBI has in its possession that shows any evidence of an alleged impact, which it does not. Below is the key paragraph from the sworn, under penalty of perjury, affidavit report by FBI Special Agent McGuire in response to an FOIA request to investigate, to look at, and report back about all 85 videos. Quote, out of the remaining 13 videotapes, which did show the Pentagon crash site even, 12, in other words, all but one, of those videotapes showed the Pentagon after the alleged impact. And she says, under oath, FBI agent, I determined that only a single videotape showed the alleged impact of Flight 77 into the Pentagon on September 11th, and that is that famous five frames that has the wrong date and the wrong time, and they are hiding the time of that fireball for obvious reasons. So why is the Pentagon hiding the attack fireball time? Because, of course, the first violent event happened over 5 minutes before the official story says Flight 77 was anywhere close to that building. And the real time exposes what really happened.
In addition to the early white plane approach and destruction at 9:32 and 30 seconds, as we have already seen,
this should give you a hint. The FBI's official 911 investigation codename is Pent Bomb. It's not Pent Plane. And this stands for, officially, Pentagon Twin Towers Bombing. The FBI actually lied outright to one of the Jersey girls who had lost their husbands in the World Trade Center towers on 9/11, telling them that, quote, all of its investigation abbreviations end in bomb. This is a lie. The anthrax investigation, for instance, which is, of course, related to 9/11, does not. It is codenamed by the FBI Amerithrax, not Ameribomb. And as well, codenames for investigations known to be about bombings do end in bomb. For example, the Oklahoma City bombing investigation is codenamed Oak Bomb. So it should tell us something that the FBI's codename for the entire 9/11 investigation is Pent Bomb. That it was the code name of the entire 9/11 investigation was reconfirmed by the FBI's own director, Robert Mueller, in 2011. The terrorist hunter, this is the cover image on that issue, which was right after the alleged killing of Osama bin Laden. FBI Director Mueller to Time Magazine, May 10th, 2011. Quote, the FBI's Strategic Intelligence Operations Center filled to capacity on September 11th and remained that way through Pent Bomb. The FBI's, this is still part of the director's quote, the FBI's cryptonym for Pentagon, Twin Towers, and bombing. The official story states there were no bombs at the Pentagon, that there were no bombs at the World Trade Center, that there were no pre-placed explosives, nanothermite or otherwise, at the World Trade Center or at the Pentagon. The FBI knows otherwise. The real story at the Pentagon, just as at the World Trade Center, is pre-placed explosives. But before we get into this compelling evidence for inside explosives, first I want to go back to this very large elephant in the room, the real attack time. The first attack on the Pentagon, and there was more than one, was not at almost 9:38, or even the white plane explosion time of 9:32 and 30 seconds, but according to inside witnesses, just after 9:30. Wedge 2, and remember Wedge 2 was from the center line of the West Wall to the left in the north, which was not yet hardened. Wedge 2 E-ring Army Specialist April Gallup, a very famous Pentagon witness, her wristwatch was stopped by a major inside explosion, she insists, just after 9:30. Now, of course, her watch may have been slightly off, in which case her watch could have been stopped by the same violent event at 9:32 and 30 seconds. However, I doubt it, because the explosions that she experienced went off inside the building and did not go through the wall. And whatever happened to the white plane also did not go through the wall. They were separate events. And she claims also that this major inside explosion just after 9:30 happened as she hit the on button on her computer. And she was also far from the Wedge 1 alleged impact point, much further to the left or the north in Wedge 2. Also, when I looked at the early times of reports from presumably Pentagon sources themselves as to when the attack on the Pentagon happened, they were all, quote, about 9:30 a.m., about 9:30, USA Today, Reuters, New York Times, Frederick Freelance Star, U.S. News and World Report. And as time went by and as the official lie solidified, the times got later and later and later until the Pentagon finally settled and the 9/11 Commission report, Big Lie, settled on almost 9:38. Official testimony and records of the real early time of the Pentagon attack. White House counsel, later Attorney General Alberto Gonzalez himself, stated in an official taped Navy lecture, and I have the tape, quote, the Pentagon was attacked at 9:32. The FAA official timeline says the Pentagon was attacked at 9:32. Denmark's about-to-be Foreign Minister Per Stig Møller says the Pentagon was attacked at between 9:32 and 9:34. If the Pentagon was really attacked, not at almost 9:38, but at a little bit after 9/32, you would expect major official reactions by the Bush-Cheney administration to happen immediately after the Pentagon attack. And that's happened. That is true. There was an E-4B command and control plane circling over Washington, D.C. at 9:30. And then the Pentagon explosion happened. And then a White House evacuation happened while presumed Flight 77 was still miles and miles from Washington. The Pentagon attack triggered the White House and other federal building evacuations, which happened just after 9:32. Quote, Newsweek, at about 9:30 a.m., Secret Service men told staffers leaving, that is evacuating the White House West Wing, to run, not walk, as far away as possible. Washington Post online version on the day of the attack, September 11th itself, the crash at the Pentagon triggered immediate security steps in the Washington area, including evacuation of the West Wing of the White House. It was the Pentagon attack that caused all of officialdom to finally act as if they were really being attacked, not the World Trade Center attacks. It's amazing. The approximately 9:32 Pentagon attack also finally triggered the Secret Service to remove Bush from the Florida classroom. Remember, he just kept sitting there? I was watching in a split screen with Bush continuing to look at the kids reading the book on a pet goat, while on the other, innocent Americans were jumping to their deaths from the Twin Towers. After inexplicitly allowing President Bush to sit for 8 to 9 minutes in a Florida classroom, after he had already been told, according to him and Andrew Card, but we have to take their word for it, don't we, that the second World Trade Center tower had been hit and that, quote, America is under attack, Card allegedly told him in his ear, the Secret Service finally acted as if the ongoing attacks were a true emergency, but only after the Pentagon was attacked at the actual time of the attack that I'm telling you about, 9:32. In 30 seconds. Only then did they whisk Bush out of the Florida classroom. And at approximately 9:32, taking him to his limousine, which left at 9:35. In response to the actual approximate 9:32 Pentagon attack, Andrews Air Force Base went on alert, quote, between 9:30 and 9:35. Official story says Flight 77 didn't even hit the building until almost 9:38. The offer of interceptors to the Secret Service by Major Daniel Kane of Andrews Air Force Base came immediately after World Trade Center 2 was hit, was initially declined. But the Secret Service suddenly changed its mind right after the Pentagon at 9:33. White plane explodes there at 9:30 seconds earlier. At 9:33, Langley Air Force Base interceptor pilot Dean Eckman received a shoot-down order for any planes coming within 30 miles of Washington, right after the explosion of a plane at the Pentagon. And I believe that was also after inside explosions that already happened near April Gallup's desk at about 9:30. Even in New York City, where two attacks on the World Trade Center towers had already happened and not yet caused a shutdown of the New York Stock Exchange, the exchange was finally shut down, according to the New York Times, at 9:32, which is a shorthand for right after 9:32 and 30 seconds. Firefighters were at the Pentagon fighting fires before the official story, almost 9:38 alleged impact time of Flight 77. And those were, of course, the Pentagon firefighters. One of them leapt under the van, the other one raced out on the lawn, and there was a third who survived the destruction inside the heliport firehouse, and they immediately started fighting fires. There wasn't any other plane approach or impact at that building at any level that could have impacted, like the white plane. Additional evidence for inside the building primary explosions at the Pentagon, similar to what you already know about pre-placed inside explosives at the World Trade Centers 1, 2, and 7. Evidence that the Wedge 1 collapse, Wedge 1 again, the official story place of the alleged impact of Flight 77. Evidence of the Wedge 1 collapse over the alleged plane penetration damage path on the inside of the building was in fact due to explosives. I'm about to give you that evidence, including possibly thermite. These are images on the top of the Oklahoma City Murrah Federal Building after it was known to have been destroyed by inside bombs as well as an outside truck bomb, but we know that there were at least four internal bombs in addition to the cover story outside rider truck bomb. And then at the bottom is the Pentagon after collapse of the section of Wedge 1 over the alleged impact point of Flight 77, using Al-Qaeda hijackers as the cover story. Witnesses to the sounds of a series of explosions also in the Pentagon use almost identical language to World Trade Center firefighters describing the going off of pre-placed controlled demolition explosives. So here are just some of these witnesses. Lieutenant McCowan, first floor D ring in the Naval Command Center of the Pentagon on 9/11, quote, "It sounded like a series of explosions going off, a series of bombs exploding, similar to like firecrackers when you light them and you just get that series going off." Again, identical language to the description of firefighters from the Nade Brothers video of the World Trade Center saying they went off like firecrackers coming down.
It was like, as if they had detonated. As if they were planned to take down a building. Boom, 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 boom.
And it just started going pop. It just started going boom, 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 boom. And he goes, "How fast?" I go, "Like firecrackers."
Lieutenant Colonel Thurman, second floor D ring of the Pentagon on 9/11, "To me, it didn't seem like a plane. To me, it seemed like it was a bomb. Being in the military, I've been around grenade and artillery explosions." In other words, he's been around bombs. "It was a two-part explosion to me. It seemed like there was a percussion blast that blew me kind of backwards in my cubicle to the side, and then it seemed as if a massive explosion went off at the same time." This graphic, which is a little bit difficult to see, shows the explosion that McCowan and Thurman experienced. This is from the Pentagon Building Performance Report. That's a vertical rectangle that is in orange, and the building, the official Pentagon Building Performance Report itself states that that damage on the first floor was probably due to an independent, that is independent of any plane impact, explosion, as fire would have at most, the official story is fire, would have at most collapsed the second floor downward, not thrusted upward. So what that rectangle is the area where the ceiling of the first floor and the floor of the second floor was pushed upwards by a very major force. And it could not have been due to a lateral plane impact. Which probably means that this famous photograph at the Pentagon wall is of that explosion. Why? If you notice that this fireball in the center of the wall, which may or may not be the same fireball seen in that famous five frames, but this looks like the white yellow hot of a thermite explosion to me. Whether it is or not is remains to be seen, but if you notice, there are two separate sources of smoke. To the right, or which is to the south, is the major billowing black smoke cloud that everybody knows about. But there's a second one to the left, which is at the heliport, and they are separate. And neither of those smoke clouds are coming from that fiery point. Now compare what you just saw at the Pentagon to the explosion of a plane hitting a cement wall. It's nothing like it. There's no pulverized cement debris. Instead, as we are going to see, that the Pentagon wall at that point turned to mush. So I have to ask myself, was thermite placed somewhere at or around the columns of the so-called plane penetration path on the inside of the Pentagon? An autopsy of the concrete of the destroyed and damaged support columns on the inside of the Pentagon in the alleged internal penetration path of Flight 77 in the E-ring showed the effect of intense, concentrated, and prolonged heat that, according to the experts who analyzed it, turned some of the concrete literally to mush. And that mush had a reddish and orange tinge due, according to them, to their report, to the presence of iron. Now, we know from the analysis of Niels Herrett and Richard Gage and others at the World Trade Center, both sudden intense heat, like you saw in that fireball, that white, yellow-hot fireball at the Pentagon wall, and the resultant molten iron are signatures of the reaction of thermite on steel. This is a photograph from the Pentagon Building Performance Report of what's inside the columns of the West Wedge. These are reinforced steel supports.
In fact, a massive explosion happened at just the time of the collapse of the outer wall over the alleged plane impact point, which is yet further evidence that another internal explosion caused that collapse. This is a live video clip from the Pentagon that morning. Note the time on the clip of 10:10 a.m.
And once again, on the left-hand side of your screen, you are looking at the Tower 2, the first one. This is all New York now.
Michael, if you can hear me, we just heard another explosion down at the Pentagon building. We just heard another loud explosion down at the Pentagon building just seconds ago.
That's our Audrey Barnes, who is standing nearby the Pentagon, saying they heard a second explosion. Audrey, did you see anything since these other attacks have been aerial? Did you see anything flying overhead just before this explosion?
We can't see exactly where the source of the explosion was, but you could hear it very clearly with a loud boom, and I'm looking for another plume of smoke. I don't see anything right now. It might be still in that same general area where the fire is burning right now, but you can clearly hear another loud explosion.
This Pentagon Performance Report graphic also falsely claims, if you notice across the upper part, those little red or orange dots, those are on the columns, the outside columns. Column 14, kind of in the middle, is where the official story says Flight 77's nose hit, and then it went in at a diagonal angle. And down in the lower right is the alleged C-ring exit hole. The Pentagon Building Performance Report falsely claims that eight, those are those orange dots, that eight external columns were destroyed. However, that is not true. And this is the proof of it. I was very excited when I found this extremely rare and extremely important photograph. It's the only one I know of that is very clear that was taken after the initial fires were out at the Pentagon wall. This is at the alleged official story impact point, but before the collapse of the wall over this very area. And what you see is that almost all the damage, in fact, as the Pentagon Building Performance Report itself said, I would say at least 90% of the damage, if not more, was on the first floor, and only a very small percentage where you see that kind of T with the two windows on either side that where the glass is blown out on the second floor. But if you notice, there are the columns, even though they're bowed out, are still standing to the right of under the T and over to the left. And there are only four columns that are missing, not eight, which is impossible for the official story of a plane that had a wingspan of 124 feet. You're looking at only 50 feet of a non-round impact hole. And many people in the 9/11 truth movement falsely have claimed that, inadvertently or otherwise, that this T area with the windows blown out on either side on the second floor in the center of the photograph, that that is the so-called entrance hole of the plane. It is not. And what they do is they show photographs that don't show the bottom floor at all. And then remember, of course, that that the columns were bowed out and not in, as they would be from an external impact of a very large, fast-flying object of great force.
And at the Pentagon on the morning of 9/11, you saw all of these fire trucks putting out their mist and spray and foam. I believe the real purpose of that mist and spray and foam, which really wasn't putting out fires at that point,
was to prevent you from seeing that there was not an alleged impact hole where the official story claimed that it was. So, we have seen that the physical evidence clearly supports primary inside explosives. By primary inside explosives, I mean that aren't the result of the impact of a plane or fires therefrom. Yes, there were reports by eyewitnesses also of explosions and explosives throughout the chain of command from the very highest levels of the Pentagon on down. Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld and his three-star top military aide. When Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld was asked by Sam Donaldson what happened at the Pentagon right after the attacks, he said, "A bomb?" Acting head of the National Military Command Center, Captain Charles Leidig. He, Captain Leidig, had no awareness of Flight 77 coming back to Washington, D.C. at all. His first awareness was a call from Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld's three-star aide, that's an extremely high military officer, who asked if he, meaning Leydig, felt the explosion in the building and asked Leydig to investigate whether it might be a terrorist attack. Witnesses to cordite and gunpowder, which has an extremely distinct smell from jet fuel and kerosene, burning jet fuel and kerosene. Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff himself, General Shelton, upon arriving at the Pentagon on 9/11, has said in his memoirs, page 434 of called Without Hesitation, quote, the smell of cordite or gunpowder was overwhelming. Don Perkel, another witness, people shouted in the corridor outside my office that a bomb had gone off. Even before stepping outside, I could smell the cordite. Then I knew explosives had been set off somewhere. And many other witnesses as well. So, according to the official story then, the only primary damage at the Pentagon was in the outer E, D, and C rings in Wedge 1, due solely to the impact and resultant fires and damage from a plane. 90 to 95% on the ground floor, a little bit on the second floor, and going only into the inside of the C ring. However, that is not what happened. There is, in fact, major damage on 9/11 in the innermost rings, the A and B rings as well. In an interview that I personally did at the Naval Postgraduate School with the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations on 9/11, former top Green Beret, Robert Andrews, he told me, quote, as he drew a diagram of it, which I've retained, quote, my aide and I had to walk over dead bodies on the inside of the innermost A ring, unquote. Also, the B ring, next in from the C ring towards the center courtyard, the B ring between the fourth and fifth quarters was decimated, Washington Post. Pentagon rescue team to the Washington Post on 9/11, its online version, that day of the attacks. Quote, when we got into the building, we started to feel the heat right away, and as we walked deeper down the hallways, deeper means towards the center, not away from it, it got hotter and hotter, not cooler and cooler. It was just fire everywhere, not so much smoke, but just fire all around us. You couldn't see the plane, you couldn't see anything of a plane, just debris everywhere you looked. And again, deeper means deeper towards the center of the building. And as we have seen, there was a major internal explosion at or just after 9:30 near April Gallup's desk. According to her sworn videotape testimony, April Gallup experienced all of the below at 9:30. The time that a massive inside the building explosion near her desk stopped her wristwatch. This was in the outer E-ring in Wedge 2, which, remember, is at least 150 feet north of where the official story claims a plane hit the wall almost 8 minutes later. April Gallup said she, quote, thought I had triggered it when I touched the on button on my computer. I thought it was a bomb, unquote. Gallup saw no plane, no plane parts, no seats, no passengers, no passenger bodies, and no luggage inside the building. And she said there was no smell of jet fuel and no jet fuel fires that she saw. In fact, the only fires April Gallup said she saw were coming out of the computers, which was also experienced by other inside the building witnesses, for example, by Tracy Webb in the E-ring off of corridor 4, which was in the alleged penetration path of the alleged plane. April Gallup said the floor was not hot inside the building as she walked out with just one shoe and one bare foot, and yet the sole of her bare foot was completely unburned, as we're about to see in the photo in the next slide. And in addition, some dozen other inside the building witnesses in the area where April Gallup worked, she meets with them and they confirm her experience. And here is a picture of April Gallup on the lawn. This is what happened inside the Wedge 2 to the north or the left of the center line. And notice that she is not burned, and those are the bottom of her feet. And she has testified under oath to me in a two-hour under oath videotaped interview and testimony that she lost one of her shoes, and she walked over whatever it was she walked over that was allegedly, according to the official story, burning jet fuel, and she wasn't burned, including on the bottom of her bare foot.
On September 11, 2001, I had returned back from maternity leave. I had to get Elijah situated in daycare. I walked into the building. I had to clear Elijah to go to the area. There were some things that they wanted me to take care of prior to me taking him to the daycare. I sat down at the computer to actually turn the computer on. As soon as I pressed the button, boom. So at that particular time, based off what happened, I thought I had triggered a bomb. I was covered from my neck all the way down to my back in debris. My son was completely blown out of his stroller, and some of the floors had collapsed within, and people were trapped in between the floors. My son had stopped crying, so I felt strength out of nowhere to actually low crawl from out under the debris to try to find my son. While I was coming out of the Pentagon, I didn't see any evidence of metal, airplane seats, luggage, nothing that would give me any indication that it was a plane that had hit the building. I lost one shoe, so I was walking through the area barefooted. So I was particularly careful to try to make sure I did not step on anything sharp while I had my son on my shoulder. I did not have jet fuel over my body. My son didn't have jet fuel over his body. The people that I helped didn't have jet fuel on their body. So again, there was nothing on the inside that would give me any indication that there was a plane on that particular day that hit the building. Most of the people that were in the area where I was located, and again, I did ask because maybe I was off in my judgment, but in speaking with everyone, it was conclusive that no one else in the area where I was located had seen any parts of planes or luggage or baggage or anything of that nature. Yes, I believe it's something part of much more sinister, and that's why my goal is to try to push for a federal grand jury so that people can be brought forth for perjury and obstruction of justice. I mean, when you go out of your way to fabricate an official story, when obviously the evidence that appears, whether it's footage or the work that many people have done, shows that the official story couldn't possibly be true, then yes, you should be brought to justice. And when people can come together and feel like they can utilize, human beings as lambs to a slaughter, yes, that's what's unpatriotic, that's what's un-American. When we'll turn our own people to sacrifice them for whatever their motive may be, regardless that their motive is of no significance, but the fact that they would use innocent human beings as lambs to a slaughter to perpetrate whatever it is their cause or motive is. Yes, they should be brought to justice, and it's obvious, that the official story is it has been fabricated.
And here is an aerial photo showing a large E-ring cavity inside the outer E-ring wall of Wedge 2, not just Wedge 1, where the official story says a plane impacted and there was later a collapse. April Gallup, also, you should know, for 9/11 truth aficionados, did not walk out of the alleged entrance hole. Of course, there wasn't an entrance hole to begin with to walk out of. But the first official interview that she gave, which was to the Army historians, she stated that she and her son exited through a window behind the Fort Myer fire truck that you have already seen, the back of which was on fire after the white plane exploded there at 9:32:30 and stopped the heliport clock at that time. And the Army historians also interviewed the other people that helped her and her infant son out of that blown out window just behind the fire truck. And here you see the fire truck, and you can see the blown out window behind the back of the fire truck. And then just as the outer columns, as we've seen to the right and left of the alleged impact point of Flight 77 in Wedge 1 were bowed outwards, not inwards, in other words, consistent with an internal explosion with its pressure wave coming out instead of an external impact by a large, heavy, fast-flying object. Similarly, in Wedge 2, further north, where April Gallup worked, a massive internal force thrust office debris towards the outer windows. And you can see them. If this were a higher resolution photo, you could clearly see that this office debris is just forced out of the windows. Windows also first bowed out and then back in. Witness Lieutenant Colonel Victor Correa, who worked in the office of the Army Deputy Chief of Staff for Personnel, in the direct path of the alleged official story, penetration of Flight 77, said, quote, "I noticed the windows going out and then coming back in. We thought it was some kind of an explosion, that somebody had got in there and planted bombs because of that." Army Fort Monmouth TDY auditor Michael Nielsen, whom I personally interviewed, told me, quote, "Hundreds of people raced down the halls past him out the south side exit, shouting, 'It's a bomb, bombs, it's a bomb,' i.e. explosives. And as a plane did not hit at the Wedge 1 impact point, this famous five frames video, which we're showing again, is therefore evidence of what? Only of an explosion and or the white plane destruction. Not of an impact. There were also multiple primary inside explosions independent of any impact or fires therefrom. We've already seen April Gallup says that her watch was stopped by this massive explosion by her desk in Wedge 2 at 9:30, at 9:31.
And 40 seconds.
Stopped Navy area clock, which we saw very early with this firehouse clock. And at precisely 9:43, the, according to the official story, sole survivor of the Naval Command Center, which was the second and third rings in the alleged penetration path of Flight 77, stated at precisely 9:43 was the explosion in the Naval Command Center. At 10 o'clock, explosives went off on columns in the alleged penetration path. And at 9:48, there was another large Pentagon explosion. There were bombs going off inside the buildings over quite a long period of time.
This slide shows the relative times of the inside the building explosions at the Pentagon on 9/11 relative to the outside explosions at the Pentagon that morning. At 9:30, as we have seen in Wedge 2, well to the north of where the official story says Flight 77 allegedly impacted, almost 8 minutes later, April Gallup's wristwatch was stopped by a massive explosion inside the building. At 9:30. At 9:31 and 40 seconds, another inside the building explosion stopped the Navy area clock. Now, this was also the likely time of the D-ring explosion that thrust the second floor slab upwards. And then there is an external explosion, the one we know about at 9:32 and 30 seconds, when the white plane was destroyed near the heliport, stopping the heliport firehouse clock at that time. But there was also another external explosion, and that was at approximately 9:34 and 10 seconds. That was when the huge billowing black smoke cloud started to billow upwards from a diesel trailer fire outside the Wedge 1 wall near the official story alleged impact point. And we know that time because it was caught on the DoubleTree Hotel security camera digital clock. The next inside the building explosion, and this was at, quote, precisely 9:43. According to Lieutenant Kevin Schaefer, who according to the official story was the only survivor of the Naval Command Center that morning, he said that a massive orange fireball explosion went off in the Naval Command Center at precisely 9:43. And at 9:48, according to the Secret Service's log that morning, there was yet another Pentagon explosion. And the well-known explosion at the Pentagon at approximately 10 a.m., explosives likely went off on inside columns in the alleged penetration path of Flight 77, causing the Wedge 1 E-ring collapse over the alleged impact point at about 10 o'clock.
The Pentagon also was expecting explosives. According to AP report on 9/11 itself, the Pentagon attack came minutes after Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld predicted there will be another event. There were bomb-sniffing dog teams at the Pentagon before the attack. Inside explosives at the Pentagon, just as at the World Trade Center, explain why there was no advanced siren to alert personnel of alleged approaching danger to evacuate the building, as there was no incoming at the time of the alleged official story Pentagon attack. The National Military Command Center didn't learn of any alleged incoming hijacked plane until 9:31, after the explosion. There was no way for non-perpetrators of the actual inside job to know the explosives were about to go off in order to trigger alarms and an evacuation. And April Gallup and many others testified, there was no alert to trigger them to leave the building to save their lives. Even after Pentagon workers shouted a bomb had gone off, still no alarm sounded, according to Don Perkel. And the chief NBC Pentagon correspondent on 9/11, Jim Miklaszewski, I believe, stated, at 9:45, still no sirens and no official evacuation order. Primary inside explosions at the Pentagon are absolute proof of what? An inside job. Outside terrorists, whether Al-Qaeda or Santa Claus, could not have done it. Non-insider terrorists would have targeted the easy-to-hit roof or the central courtyard or the offices of high-ranking officials on the far side from the official impact point, where Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, had their offices. They would never have chosen the least populated, newly hardened West Wedge, which was also the hardest to hit due to many physical obstacles in the path, a hill, an antenna, light poles, a chain link fence, and the 6 foot high spools. Now you're going to see evidence that some of these, at least some, if not all of the inside explosives were targeted to take out particular functions and perhaps even individuals. The Naval Command Center was targeted not by a plane, but by inside explosives. This is a graphic from the Washington Post immediately after the attacks that was actually titled The Targeted Ones. And it's a little bit difficult to see, but where they show that the plane, alleged that the plane hit at the official story point, then there is that kind of gray, darker gray area, and within that is the Naval Command Center, which is blown up in the legend up at the top. And in the right-hand corner is number 8, which is the Naval Intelligence Cell. And that turns out to be very important. The Naval Command Center official story is that only one person survived the Naval Command Center on 9/11. That's important because that part was between 2 and 3 rings in from the official story alleged impact point of the plane. It says that only Kevin Schaefer was the survivor at the Naval Command Center. He became a top staffer, I think not coincidentally, on the key 9/11 commission subgroup that was allegedly investigating the Pentagon attack and DOD's NORAD's non-response, which was the heart of the 9/11 PSYOP, including 3 NORAD versions, at least, as Professor Griffin has pointed out, at least 2 of which must be false, if not all 3. Just briefly, the Naval Command Center cover-up is important because I interviewed Rear Admiral Hathaway, who was in charge of the Naval Command Center on 9/11, and he told me that the official story is not true, that Lieutenant Kevin Schaefer was not the only survivor, that in that little intel cell, he stated that there in the intelligence cell, which was a hardened room, hardened against bombs itself on the inside of the Pentagon, there were 18 to 19 intelligence officers, most of whom also survived. Why is that not part of the official story? Follow the money. Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld and the Pentagon's comptroller,
Dov Zakheim,
publicly acknowledged the day before 9/11 on September 10th that the Pentagon was missing and could not account for $2.3 trillion.
The adversary is closer to home. It's the Pentagon bureaucracies. According to some estimates, we cannot track $2.3 trillion.
Mr. Secretary, according to the Comptroller General of the United States, there are serious financial management problems at the Pentagon, to which Mr. Cooper alluded. Fiscal year 1999, $2.3 trillion missing. Fiscal year 2000, $1.1 trillion missing. And DOD is the number one reason why the government can't balance its checkbook. The Pentagon has claimed year after year that the reason it can't account for the money is because its computers don't communicate with each other. My second question, Mr. Secretary, is who has the contracts today to make those systems communicate with each other? How long have they had those contracts? And how much have the taxpayers paid for them? Finally, Mr. Secretary, after the last hearing, I thought that my office was promised a written response to my question regarding the 4 war games on September 11th. I have not yet received that response, but would like for you to respond to the questions that I've put to you today, and then I do expect the written response to my previous question, hopefully by the end of the week.
Thank you, Representative. The second question, I've forgotten what the second question was.
Susan Lindauer has stated publicly at the Vancouver hearings, at which I was also a speaker and an expert witness, that the CIA knew this was actually $5 trillion at that time. The Army financial audit area and the records therein were destroyed in the attack in the area close to April Gallup's desk with those inside explosives that she insists went off right around 9:30. And she also, if you recall, claimed that the only fires she saw on the inside of the E-ring and Wedge 2 were coming out of the Army area computers. Flight 77 not only did not hit the Pentagon, it didn't get anywhere close, and it was never ID'd, ever, affirmatively ID'd, as the eastward flying plane that approached the Pentagon at almost 9:38. With Barbara Olson's phone calls now officially non-existent per the FBI, American Airlines, and the Pentagon, there is, according to Professor David Ray Griffin, and I agree with him, zero, that is no evidence that the outgoing plane, whatever it was, even turned back east. And with its transponder off, Dulles Air Traffic Control had only a blip, never a positive ID, and did not have any altitude or speed, which has been confirmed in a videotaped interview by Secretary of Transportation Norman Mineta, that when he talked to the FAA, to Monty Belger, that Belger said they did not have altitude or speed. And there was a C-130 pilot that allegedly saw the attack on the Pentagon. That is not true. He never ID'd the plane, and he did not see the impact.
Which can be proven from the now-released audio tapes from the air traffic control tower that the C-130 pilot was talking to, and from the radar records. Regarding the plane that took off from Dulles at 8:20, the reason I said, quote, whatever it was, unquote, is because the Official Bureau of Transportation, or BTS, online database statistics for all live civilian flights that flew on 9/11 that morning does not include Flight 77.
The FDR, the flight data recorder data fields, also, this alleged flight data recorder from Flight 77 that one group of officials at the Pentagon said was found just inside the entrance hole, and another group of Pentagon officials said was found just inside the exit hole. The flight data recorder data fields that could have positively identified the FDR as coming from Flight 77 or even from any American Airlines plane at all had been zeroed out. And according to FDR expert Dennis Cimino, had been intentionally removed. This is further proof that the flight data recorder data, importantly based upon which the Pentagon has claimed that it learned the time of the attack of almost 9:38 from the FDR. Further proof it was doctored is that the data from that FDR was downloaded 4 hours before the Pentagon reportedly found it. Why the 9:37 and 46 seconds so-called, I call it the FDR or radar data plane, cannot be Flight 77? At 8:54 and 43 seconds, Indianapolis FAA Air Traffic Control, which was tracking what they believed was Flight 77, began a descent before the official story says it turned back east. And it had already descended, according to the Christian Science Monitor, some 6,000 feet by the time its transponder was turned off. However, according to the official story, to the Pentagon itself, the flight data recorder plane, alleged to be Flight 77, didn't begin its descent until after the turn back east of whatever plane it was, and didn't begin its descent until 9:01. And as the same physical plane cannot do both, the official story FDR plane cannot be Flight 77. Thus, the flight data recorder allegedly found in the Pentagon rubble, whether it was found, wherever it was found, claimed to have been from this 9:38 plane also cannot have been from Flight 77. So if the FDR plane that approached the Pentagon at almost 9:38 wasn't Flight 77, what was it? Evidence it was a military plane. All of the Dulles air traffic controllers thought it was a military plane. Daniel O'Brien, who was the Dulles air traffic controller tracking that blip, said the speed, the maneuverability, the way he turned, and again, there was no altitude and no speed information attached to this. We all thought in the radar room, they were then many people standing around her back looking at the screen. We all thought in the radar room, all of us experienced air traffic controllers, that it was a military plane.
In the room, it was almost a sense of relief. This must be a fighter. This must be one of our guys.
So, what happened to Flight 77? The bottom line is we don't know. The government needs to tell us. This is what we do know. We know that at 9:09 and 55 seconds, FAA, Indianapolis Air Traffic Control, reported that flight missing, the flight that had left Dulles Airport at 8:20 in the morning, reported it missing and possibly crashed to the Air Force Search and Rescue. It is not a coincidence, in my opinion, that it was at this exact second, almost, that military air traffic controllers first, in quotes, reported picking up the never positively identified eastward flying blip, that they then violated all established protocol to assume and claim was Flight 77, but it was not, clearly intended, in my opinion, to stop the Air Force from search and rescue. The non-coincidence of this timing, I believe, is strong evidence that the military had been tracking the eastward flying plane all along via military transponder mode that only it and not the FAA civilian air traffic controllers could see. And thus, for the military, there was no so-called radar hole, making the plane invisible for this part of its flight. And also, that the official story plane, alleged to have been Flight 77, was a military plane giving off a friendly, identify friend or foe IFF transponder signal would explain why it did not trigger any interceptor response and was not shot down. Therefore, in my opinion, I do not believe that there was any stand-down order needed to explain what happened at the Pentagon for two important reasons. One, it wasn't a civilian airliner. We've shown that by many means. And it didn't get through the system, the defense system, to hit the building in any case. In summary, Flight 77 was nowhere near the Pentagon when inside explosives went off over 5 minutes before it allegedly even approached the building, was nowhere near the Pentagon when a white plane with two stripes, red and blue, or red, orange, and blue, made to simulate an American airline plane, exploded near or at the heliport, stopping the heliport clock at 9:32 and 30 seconds, over 5 minutes before the official story says Flight 77 got anywhere near the Pentagon. Also, there is zero evidence that whatever plane left Dulles at 8:20 turned back east at all towards Washington, D.C. in any case. And the westward flying blip was reported possibly crashed by FAA to Air Force Search and Rescue before it even turned east. And even if whatever plane was flying east had hit the Pentagon, which it didn't, we have proven, it couldn't have penetrated to just the inside of the C-ring, as claimed by the official story, and have caused the massive destruction found all the way into the innermost A and B rings. And finally, the FDR plane, alleged to have been Flight 77, was almost certainly a military plane. The real story at the Pentagon, I believe, I have proven to you, is thus the same as the real story at the World Trade Center on 9/11. That story is pre-placed inside the building explosives with plane approaches and impacts and or destructions of the plane as the cover causes. And inside explosives at both the World Trade Center and the Pentagon can mean only one thing. 9/11 was literally an inside job. How do we identify the operational mass murderers? We would need to know who made and controlled the weaponized military-grade nanothermite that has been found, some of it unreacted, in the World Trade Center dust, number one. And I believe we would need to know who made and controlled the weaponized nanospores in the anthrax letters, which were dated September 11th, after all, and who specializes in nanosol gel processes, which use silicon and silica that are found both in the World Trade Center dust and in the anthrax letter spores. And who would that be? So who could have controlled weapons-grade nanothermite of the signature in the World Trade Center dust? Well, I found out. This is at least one serious possibility. It may not be the only one, but remember, this is an inside job. Quote, from Army Major Doug Rocky,
retired director of the United States Army's depleted uranium project, to both myself and Professor Stephen Jones in Irvine, California. I was standing only approximately 1.5 feet from him when he said this. The only guys I know who have this stuff are the golden boys at the Army's Redstone Arsenal. So who controlled the super military grade nano anthrax in the anthrax letters? According to the world's foremost independent investigator of the anthrax letter attacks, Barry Kissen, who is an attorney in the Washington, D.C. area, the answer is Battelle Memorial Institute, which is a U.S. government military intelligence lab, and the CIA, and possibly also the Defense Intelligence Agency, there's the Army again, Dugway Proving Ground. And I learned from my research that William Patrick, who is now deceased, he was one of the U.S. government's top bioweapons experts, used to work at Fort Detrick also, that William Patrick held the private trade secret, one would should ask why private, the private trade secret to the process to create the 1 trillion spores per gram anthrax that was found in the letters. Who could handle military-grade explosives and anthrax that were found in the World Trade Center dust and the anthrax letters? Once they have been created, I would think it would take a military special operators, black ops, trained in super weaponized nanoparticles to set nano explosives and deliver nanobiological weapons. This would be a highly trained, highly specialized black joint special operations team, I would think, like in particular the Joint Special Operations Command, JSOC, and that works hand in glove with the CIA's Special Activities Division, which we learned from New York Times articles operate above the law with exemption to execute covert operations inside the United States on behalf of the president. In that time, of course, the president was George W. Bush. But as we'll see, JSOC was actually overseen by Vice President Cheney. The Joint Forces Command also happens to script, plan, and run the military's exercises and war games. And we have seen that on the morning of 9/11, they were running NORAD, Northeast Sector, which was responsible for not responding, that the NORAD's Northeast Sector was running an extra hijack scenario exercise on the morning of 9/11 itself. And the FAA hijack coordinator on 9/11, who should have been at his desk, Army Lieutenant General Michael Canavan, guess what he'd done just before that? He'd headed JSOC. When Canavan first took the job, only about 9 months before 9/11, he began running and participating in military exercises that, according to FAA Intelligence Division analyst John Hawley, quote, pretty damn close to the 9/11 plot itself. And on the morning of 9/11, Canavan's whereabouts were, quote, unknown, and the 9/11 Commission didn't consider it important enough to ask where he was. Under whose command is JSOC? According to Cy Hirst, Vice President Cheney oversaw the Joint Special Operations Command before and on 9/11. And Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations and forming top Army Green Beret, there's the Army again, Robert Andrews, reportedly, according to alternative press, headed Cheney's blackest dark ops under JSOC. Susan Lindauer has sworn under oath that before 9/11, her CIA handler ordered her to threaten Iraq's UN ambassador that if they didn't turn over intelligence about imminent hijack plots with airplanes, i.e. like the 9/11 plot, that the U.S. would bomb their country, and that this threat came from, quote, higher than the CIA director and the Secretary of State, which could only mean the Secretary of Defense, Vice President Cheney, or President Bush. Stephen Pieznik, former Deputy Assistant Secretary of State to 3 U.S. presidents, has stated publicly that he is willing to name under oath to the proper venue the military general who was on Deputy Secretary of Defense's Wolfowitz staff on 9/11, who told him that the 9/11 attacks were a false flag attack. Quote, they ran the attacks, the general said of Wolfowitz, Cheney's aide Hadley, Elliot Abrams, Condoleezza Rice, among others. How did they do it? I believe the evidence shows that 9/11 was a red, white, and blue smoke and mirrors preemptive self-attack, planned and executed under cover of hijack scenario exercises, onto which the neocon high cabal, headed by Wolfowitz, Cheney, and Rumsfeld, planned and orchestrated the overlay of inside the building explosives to ensure its spectacular success, a la the Reichstag fire, while also taking out targeted offices and functions, i.e. the Naval Command Center and the Army auditors who were trying to track the $2.3 trillion that Rumsfeld had acknowledged.
We cannot track $2.3 trillion.
The day before 9/11 was allegedly missing. NORAD's Northeast Sector Operational Commander on 9/11, Colonel Bob Marr, just happens to be an expert in red team gaming verisimilitude. Verisimilitude is a fancy word for making an exercise or war game seem real. There's no better way to make it seem real than to make it real, is it? To go live. He was an expert in red team gaming verisimilitude and has publicly acknowledged that his Northeast NORAD sector was conducting hijack scenario emergency response exercises on the morning of 9/11 itself. It's in this book, Touching History. Richard Clark revealed to me in an interview I did with him at the Naval Postgraduate School as the senior military affairs journalist there on August 30th, 2010, and I published this on the DOD's website. He said that the White House clears every major exercise, as I mentioned before, meaning Condoleezza Rice and probably Cheney and Bush, and certainly Cheney, would have known about those hijack scenario exercises being run on the morning of 9/11, which were then used as part of the pretext for why NORAD didn't respond in time. White House approval of hijack scenario exercises being run on 9/11 itself would have to have been known about and approved by at least Rice and Clark. JSOC NORAD exercise scenario planners and executors were the core, I believe, of the operational plot. Why NORAD, which is an Air Force agency, lied at least twice and probably three times to Congress, as well as the 9/11 Commission, putting out three contradictory timelines of its non-responses of its fighter jets in time. And the 9/11 Commission seriously considered referring NORAD DOD to the Department of Justice for criminal investigation for lying and obstruction of justice. 9/11, in my very educated opinion, was not just an evil inside plot, it was a diabolical inside plot, whose purpose was, in my opinion, to terrorize the United States into putting Israel's interest above our own. I call that treason. To get the United States military into the Middle East, as Nicholas Rockefeller told Russo a year before 9/11. This was a longtime goal of the Project for New American Century U.S. and Israeli Zionists, to affect Israel's goals using American blood and treasure, which is still happening. CENTCOM, which stands for Central Command, the Central Combatant Command of the United States military of the Pentagon, had already, before 9/11, been moved to the Middle East. You would think that CENTCOM would be centered over the United States. Well, one of the reasons for that is, as you have already learned, there was no combatant command over the mainland United States until immediately after 9/11, when they created NORTHCOM for that very purpose.
Reported dual Israeli-U.S. citizen Paul Wolfowitz was Deputy Secretary of Defense, number two immediately under Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld.
Richard Pearl, reported dual U.S.-Israeli citizen, proclaimed himself one of the top Project for New American Century Manifesto signatories. He self-proclaimed himself the Prince of Darkness. And he chaired Rumsfeld's Defense Policy Board.
If Richard Pearl is the Prince of Darkness, Dove Zakheim is the King. Dove Zakheim is a rabbi and reported dual U.S.-Israeli citizen. He wrote a paper advocating a staged catastrophic event to force the United States into war, to reconfigure the Middle East in Israel's interest, and presented it to the Project for New American Century before they wrote the Project for New American Century Manifesto. And Zakheim is credited with the actual new Pearl Harbor quote in that manifesto. Zakheim headed all of the Pentagon's accounts as its DOD comptroller under Rumsfeld, as the $2.3 trillion was announced being missing the day before 9/11 on September 10th. CIA whistleblower Susan Lindauer says it was really $9.1 trillion and that it had gone for Israel. Pentagon auditors tracking the missing money, killed on 9/11 by inside explosives in the Pentagon, and the records were destroyed. Zakheim was the chief executive officer of Systems Planning Corporation, a defense contractor that specialized in remote control of airplanes, especially drone aircraft, used in U.S. military exercises, and a special system which destroyed them in their terminal phases. This is what the evidence shows actually happened at the Pentagon on 9/11. Systems Planning Corporation had a subsidiary that actually oversaw the 1993 World Trade Center 1 attack, so-called investigation, and through that investigation obtained the secret World Trade Center blueprints, which were needed to know where to plant controlled demolition explosives throughout the building. Dov Zakheim arranged for the Pentagon to receive leased converted Boeing 767 fuel tanker planes, which are consistent with what eyewitnesses saw of the plane that actually struck World Trade Center 2 on 9/11. Reported dual Israeli-U.S. citizen Philip Zelikow headed the 9/11 Commission cover-up as its executive director.
Reported dual U.S.-Israeli citizen Michael Chertoff headed the Department of Justice alleged, quote, investigation, which is a cover-up of 9/11. And became the second new Department of Homeland Security director. So we must ask whose homeland and whose security.
The insider 9/11 plot was the highest evil because it was premeditated. It was based on a Hitlerian scale big lie. We have seen that not just the whole official story of 9/11 is a lie, but every single individual part of it is a lie. The 9/11 plot was designed to kill masses of our innocent fellow citizens. It was designed to falsely blame and demonize Muslims who could not have done it and did not do it. It was created to justify the invasion of their lands in the Middle East for geopolitical power, oil, and Israel's interest. The aggressive 9/11 wars that have killed hundreds of thousands, displaced millions, and cost our country trillions are based entirely on lies and are the highest crime under international law and the Nuremberg Principles, which we wrote as the victors over the Nazis in World War II. So what is the source of this high evil? Incredibly, it is the mentality of Nazism. So who and what are the neocons, really? The 9/11 Pentagon neocons, Wolfowitz, Prince of Darkness himself, Richard Perle, Shalabi, Khalilzad, were all students and are followers of neocon chief philosopher Leo Strauss. They all studied under Professor Strauss at the University of Chicago. And Professor Strauss' ideology is even more extremist than his personal mentor and sponsor in Germany, Hitler's own legal theorist, Carl Schmitt. The Schmitt-Strauss doctrine is that the state needs enemies and must create them if necessary, and must fabricate lies for the many, for the people, while its leaders, quote, embrace the darkness, unquote.
We also have to work, though, sort of the dark side, if you will. We've got to spend time in the shadows.
Leo Strauss taught that, quote, those who are fit to rule are those who realize there is no morality and that there is only one so-called natural right, the right of the superior man to rule over the inferior. This is from Leo Strauss in The American Right, a book published about Strauss's so-called philosophy in 1997. Leo Strauss's neocons literally brainstormed the attacks of 9/11 decades before those attacks. Attorney Stanley Hilton studied under Leo Strauss with Paul Wolfowitz and Richard Perle at the University of Chicago. Hilton's senior thesis under Strauss detailed a plan to establish a presidential dictatorship in the United States using a fabricated Pearl Harbor-like incident as its justification. Stanley Hilton, Richard Perle, Paul Wolfowitz, Leo Strauss, and others discussed an array of different plots and incidents like September 11th and flying airplanes into buildings way back in the 1960s. And note that the book that Donald Rumsfeld, Secretary of Defense, passed out hundreds of copies of shortly before the 9/11 attacks was the 1962 book by top neocon Roberto Wolfstetter. The 9/11 neocon's mentor's mentor, therefore, was Hitler's own justifier of evil, Nazi Carl Schmitt. This is a quote from Professor Francis Boyle, an internationally renowned professor of international law at the University of Illinois. Quote, Schmitt was the most notorious Nazi law professor of his day, justifying every atrocity the Nazis inflicted on everyone. We're talking about the Holocaust. We must understand that these so-called neoconservatives are, in fact, neo-Nazis. They espouse the Nazi doctrine of Schmitt and Strauss and Machiavelli and Nietzsche, the doctrine of the Superman, unquote. This is what internationally acclaimed journalist Seymour Hersh had to say. Quote, we, that is the United States, has been taken over basically by a cult. 8 or 9 neoconservatives, we've seen they're really neo-Nazis in their mentality, have somehow grabbed the U.S. government. Just how and why they did it so efficiently, we'll have to wait for much later historians and for better documentation than we have now. But they managed to overcome the federal bureaucracy and the Congress and the press with the greatest of ease. This does say something about how fragile our democracy is. Unquote. Lawrence Wilkerson, who was chief of staff to Secretary of State Colin Powell in the Bush-Cheney administration, about this same coup said, it's not a coup, it's worse. This is how retired 4-star U.S. Army general and top NATO commander Wesley Clark put it in a 2003 public address at the Commonwealth Club in San Francisco.
What happened in 9/11 is we didn't have a strategy, we didn't have bipartisan agreement, we didn't have American understanding of it, and we had instead a policy coup in this country. A coup. A policy coup. Some hard-nosed people took over the direction of American policy, and they never bothered to inform the rest of us. Then I came back to the Pentagon about 6 weeks later. I saw the same officer. I said, why haven't we attacked Iraq? We still going to attack Iraq? He said, oh, sir. He says, it's worse than that. He said, he pulled up a piece of paper off his desk. He said, I just got this memo from the Secretary of Defense's office. It says we're going to attack and destroy the governments in 7 countries in 5 years. We're going to start with Iraq, and then we're going to move to Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. I sat on this information for a long time, for about 6 or 8 months. I was so stunned by this, I couldn't begin to talk about it. And I couldn't believe it would really be true, but that's actually what happened. These people took control of the policy in the United States. And I realized then, it came back to me, a 1991 meeting I had with Paul Wolfowitz. You know, in 2001 he was Deputy Secretary of Defense, but in 1991 he was the Under Secretary of Defense for Policy. It's the number 3 position in the Pentagon. It was a pretty stunning thing. You mean the purpose of the military is to start wars and change governments? It's not to sort of deter conflict? We're going to invade countries? And, I you know, my mind was spinning. And I put that aside. It was like a nugget that you hold on to. This country was taken over by a group of people with a policy coup. Wolfowitz and Cheney and Rumsfeld, and you could name a half dozen other collaborators from the Project for a New American Century. They wanted us to destabilize the Middle East, turn it upside down, make it under our control. It went back to those comments in 1991. Now, did anybody ever tell you that? Was there a national dialogue on this? Did senators and congressmen stand up and denounce this plan? Was there a full-fledged American debate on it? Absolutely not. And there still isn't.
The truth is, our government was and still is penetrated and controlled by a Zionist Israeli fifth column that took over the White House, the Congress, the military-civilian superstructure, key military officers and intelligence personnel and the mainstream media leading up to, on, and after 9/11. The level and extent of this penetration is unprecedented in the history of the world and amounts to a literal invasion by an un-American and hostile force. The same year, 2003, that General Wesley Clark gave that warning that the United States government, civilian superstructure of the military, key military officers and special operators and intelligence personnel had been taken over by an Israeli neocon fifth column coup, Israel's own Prime Minister, Ariel Sharon, frustrated that his Middle East destabilization and domination plan wasn't going as well and as quickly as planned, declared that the United States had already conquered Iraq. Remember Bush's famous false and absurd premature mission accomplished speech from the deck of a Navy ship that same year, 2003? Ariel Sharon went on that it was time that the U.S. marched against Libya, Syria, and Iran. Note that President Obama has made Sharon's Libya demand already a reality, that the U.S. is now destabilizing Syria by supporting none other than Al-Qaeda-affiliated Syrian so-called rebels, and that the war drums are building now for an attack on Iran. I do not believe it is a coincidence that the same lead actor who played in the movie Pearl Harbor, Ben Affleck, that prepared the ground for the American public to accept the, quote, new Pearl Harbor, unquote, meme for the inside job 9/11 attacks, just happens to be the producer, director, and leading actor of the new movie Argo, a transparent piece of Hollywood CIA propaganda which is intended to demonize Iran and prepare the American public to now accept a war against that final nation in the neocons' quickly falling row of Middle East dominoes.
Facts alone are not enough. Our 9/11 truth movement, I believe, needs to become the heart and soul, maybe the main impetus of a global truth force movement. And Mahatma Gandhi actually initiated precisely such a movement in India, which he called Truth Force or Satyagraha, on, coincidentally, September 11th. And this was pointed out by one of the speakers, I believe, from India, at an extremely important event that just happened this past November 19th, 2012, at which Richard Gage was a speaker, Michael Chosudovsky was a speaker, Cynthia McKinney was a speaker, and individuals from all around the world were speakers. It's on YouTube. It was a conference that was called Revisiting 9/11 that was orchestrated and hosted by the former Prime Minister of Malaysia. And in the audience were, they said, 30 ambassadors from 30 different countries around the world. And at that, I believe it was the Indian speaker who mentioned how important it was that Gandhi's Satyagraha movement started on September 11th, and that we need to turn the 9/11 truth movement into a worldwide truth movement to stop these secrets that they only get by with their evil because they have unnecessary secrecy. So how can our reality-based community, as George Bush and Karl Rove called us, as opposed to the lie-based community, how can we prevail over the power and the lie-based community? We need to unite the facts with the force, the satyagraha of the truth. And we do that as individual citizens. We have the power within ourselves to officialize the truth every single day, because credibility is a zero-sum game. We need to take the oath of telling the truth into our own hands. And you do that in a very simple way. You can take sworn jurate affidavits. You don't have to be a notary public to do so, but I recommend that every single one of us in the worldwide truth movement become, for a few dollars and a little bit of training, to become notary publics so that we can take sworn jurate affidavits. And most people don't know it, but in California, at least, where I live, a notary public. When a notary public notarizes a document, it becomes an official state of California document. So because credibility is a zero-sum game, if you have the lie, the people, the insiders who did the job and have covered it up with the lie, they have a lie and they have credibility. But as we increase our credibility by officializing the truth and getting witness testimonies, as I did with April Gallup, under oath, and then doing the transcript and getting a sworn jurid affidavit, making it into official state document, those can be used in court. And we need to do that with every single one of the witnesses that have already come forward. It's a simple thing to do. When I did my book, when I was researching my book, October Surprise, I was trying to, nothing had changed. I had all the same evidence like I'm showing you here, but I hadn't officialized it yet. And nobody would, they would pay attention, they would say, oh, that's very nice, yes, I agree with you, and nothing would happen in the real world. The rubber wasn't meeting the road in terms of politics or the law. And one day I had the idea, well, what the heck, you know, I have a friend who's a notary public, Betty Phillips in Pacific Grove, California, I'm gonna go take my statement of what I experienced in the Reagan campaign and about the October surprise, the truth behind the Iran side of Iran-Contra. I'm going to take that in and I'm going to type it up and I'm going to have her do a swear me up and do a sworn jurid affidavit. And when I did that, it was like people's mental doors opened up. The Democratic Party, officialdom, it went all the way to the top. And pretty soon there was a full subpoena power congressional investigation in the House of Representatives. So these, we need to officialize the truth, and we do that in a worldwide pro-truth movement, and we need to do that under the aegis and umbrella and the of Mahatma Gandhi's Satyagraha movement. Where are we now? I'm just going to very briefly review the major 9/11 truth events of the past year and how we lay the evidential groundwork to bring the real perpetrators to justice. Interestingly, even though the Pentagon attack has been kind of the black sheep of the 9/11 truth movement, which for reasons that are pretty clear to me, at the beginning of my talk, I told you why it's the most important part of the 9/11 attacks, and therefore the real perpetrators would not want the 9/11 truth movement to go there. And many people in the 9/11 truth movement even said, well, we shouldn't look at the Pentagon attack. There's too much controversy. Some people say it was a North Pass, South Pass, so we shouldn't go there. Well, even despite this, amazingly, because I focus on the Pentagon attack and have for over 11 years, I was the only invited expert witness to testify at both the Toronto 9/11 hearings and the Vancouver 9/11 hearings, which is a small miracle, really. The force is with us. It truly is. And then, of course, I mentioned the Malaysia conference. By the way, the Toronto hearings, this is very important. This is the 911 Toronto report. It just came out, I believe, last November. Every single American should own this document. This report is, my paper on the Pentagon attack is chapter 13, and there are chapters in here by all of the expert witnesses at Toronto. And this cover was intentionally designed by James Gourley, who is the editor of the report and who sponsored the Toronto hearings, which were on the 10th anniversary in Toronto, Canada. He intentionally designed the cover so that at a distance it would look identical to the 9/11 Commission report. So if you just hold up the 9/11 Commission report, this 571-page lie, you can hold up the truth by the 9/11 truth movement. So please get this, read it. It is incredibly revealing, and it shows the depth of the evidence that we have already produced, which was the whole point of the Malaysia conference that was sponsored by the former Prime Minister of Malaysia, held on the, I think, the day the 9/11 Toronto report came out. So also you should know that one of the four judges, they were called a panel, the panelists, like a panel of judges, to whom we gave our testimony at Toronto on the 10th anniversary of 9/11, one of the four judges called panelists was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Italy. And he is, to this day, the honorary Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Italy and the President, as I recall, also a title of the Supreme Court of Italy. And so this is an extremely important and serious time when we have reached, the 9/11 truth movement has reached a critical mass of evidence, including some evidence now being taken under jurid affidavit sworn testimony, which did happen at Jim Fetzer's Vancouver hearings. All of the testimony was taken sworn under oath. At the Malaysia conference, and I should mention, the former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Italy, who is one of the panelist judges at the Toronto hearings, he has the final chapter in this 911 Toronto report, and he has gone public stating, including here, that it is his intent to take it to the Chief Prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, and it doesn't really matter that to this point the United States is not a signatory to the jurisdiction of the court, because some 80 innocent victims of some 80 countries, most of whom are signatories of the International Criminal Court and therefore have jurisdiction, can bring this matter before the International Criminal Court, and that includes Italy, his country. The greatest accountability opportunity of all, in my opinion, is the upcoming 9/11 Guantanamo trial. Believe it or not, as I was on the airplane coming here, which was on January 10th, so I was reading the New York Times of January 10th about what happened the day before, January 9th, a few days ago, the chief prosecutor of the Guantanamo Military Tribunal announced Wednesday, January 9th, that he is abandoning terrorism conspiracy charges against Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the other 9/11 five. Now, why is that important? Why is that incredibly important? Why does it matter so greatly for our truth movement? The 9/11 truth movement, as I and others have shown, has proven that although Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the other 9/11 five may have conspired and plotted something like the 9/11 attacks, it is physically impossible that they were the actual perpetrators or executors of those attacks. And therefore, the chief prosecutor of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the 9/11 five has just ruled out the only charge that they could possibly be found guilty of under the facts, leaving only what they could never be found guilty of, which is the actual act. This is extremely important, and the 9/11 truth movement, I believe, needs to get this report as well as sworn affidavits as soon as possible to the defense attorneys of the 9/11 five. And in conclusion, the 9/11 truth movement, and we the citizens, we the people, must never give up. If we don't, because this is a zero-sum game, we will eventually win, and the real perpetrators will be brought to justice. Thank you. We're now going to go to the Q's and A's, so just please come to the mic and one of the two and ask your question, and I'll do my best to answer it.
My name is Dick McManus. I'm a retired counterintelligence agent from the U.S. Army, and I really agree with everything you said. I'd like to point out that the flash you saw of one of your photographs, it had to be an explosive flash. It couldn't have been a regular fire. That's the first time I've ever seen that photo.
Yes. Talking about the still photo on the side of the building that I thought might be thermite. Yes, explosive. I don't think it can be from an impact of a plane.
Right. It's more like a flash from an explosion.
Exactly.
Versus a fire. That was a really interesting thing.
And that's why I said at that point that I believe that I brought that slide out right after showing you the graphic from the Pentagon Building Performance Report showing that there was this massive explosion inside the first floor in the building that forced the floor of the second floor up.
Yeah, that was a very lucky photograph that guy caught that at that right time. Yeah. I'd just like to point out there were 7 fake terrorist alerts after 9/11. Yeah. They were all kind of coincide to the vote on the Patriot Act.
That's right.
Right after, previously, prior to the election, the second election of Bush.
Also those anthrax letters went to the 2 senators who were resisting the Patriot Act.
I was interesting to ask you that. Do you know that nano aluminum is a controlled substance that makes up nanothermite?
Yes.
Have you looked into, is there any records of who had access to nano aluminum, which is a component a necessary component in order to make nanothermite?
That's a very good question. I haven't personally, because that's been a World Trade Center question, but I know that Kevin Ryan has addressed that issue in his one of his published articles. I would recommend you read.
Do you know it took before the alleged FBI came and confiscated the videotapes from the...
It was almost instant.
I mean, do you have like instant really gets you suspicious?
No, almost. What we do know, for instance, at the Citgo gas station,
right?
At this, and as I understand it, this is interesting, the Citgo gas station, I believe, was owned by Venezuela at the time, by Hugo Chavez. Find that interesting. But in any case, the according to the person who managed or owned that station, I don't know which, the FBI arrived almost immediately, I think he said 5 minutes, something like that, at the Citgo gas station, and didn't even take the time to go up on a ladder or something and take out the film. They just ripped the whole camera off the wall. And they were doing that around the area.
And you don't know how much time it took them to get from their FBI office to the...
They were already on the scene. But the excuse or pretext they give for already being on the scene, including there were Secret Service agents already on the scene, is that before the attacks, they were expecting the president to arrive between noon and 12:30. Very convenient.
There had to be passengers. Barbara Olson was quite well known, and her husband even more so, probably. And they had to be relatives and friends of passengers. So what happened to passengers, you know? Supposedly, I mean, there should be a whole group of people that want to know what happened to whoever was supposedly on Flight 77.
Right. Well, we don't know, number one. Number two, the Bureau of Transportation BTS database, which is online, states that Flight 77 was not scheduled to even take off on the morning of 9/11 as a civilian airline flight. So we have open questions as to what happened to the passengers. It's an extremely important question. I do not know the answer to it.
Yeah, there should be some kind of history of people going to the airport. There has to be a manifest somewhere, and
yes.
Dozens of supposedly passengers.
Yes. It is interesting. It is very important, I think, that the Pentagon's own official autopsy report states that there was no Arab DNA in any of the remains from the Pentagon attack, either on the alleged plane or inside the building. Well, the official story says that Arab hijackers were in the plane. So let's put it this way. If the official story is anywhere close to being true, and I've already demonstrated that whatever was destroyed at the Pentagon near the heliport 5 minutes or more before the official story says Flight 77 was even close to the building, there apparently were not passengers in that plane at all. I believe that if Flight 77 took off with Barbara Olson and anyone else in it, any real passengers, that it either crashed or was landed shortly after it was seen by Indianapolis Air Traffic Control to lose approximately 6,000 feet before it lost its transponder signal. So it probably went down somewhere close to the tri-border area of Ohio, Kentucky, and West Virginia.
Okay. When did you first begin to question the official story?
When I first started to question the official story, well, that's an interesting question. I want to preface that with a context, and that is I started to question the official story of the release of the 52 hostages in Iran the moment that they were released as Reagan took his oath of office. And that resulted in my book, October Surprise. And I actually questioned 9/11 that we weren't being told the whole story on the day of 9/11 itself. And the red flags went up when I saw on my split screen, I don't remember which mainstream television channel it was, with Bush still sitting in the classroom looking like a deer in the headlights, as the other split screens showed Americans jumping to their deaths from the Twin Towers. There was something terribly wrong with this split picture. And from that moment on, I dedicated myself to finding out the truth and bringing the real perpetrators to justice.
My question has to do with the the large-scale operation this whole thing must be, you know, in the pre-planning, the wiring of the buildings, of the various part of this whole operation that would involve hundreds, if not thousands, of people, you know. And I can understand, you know, in a military mentality, the need to know and the compartmentalized information is really important, and I can see how people can be instructed to do certain things, like, for example, the light poles being down. Somebody had to put it there. Mm-hmm. You know, it didn't happen by itself. So, and also being that, and I can see just how this thing happened, and perhaps to a lot of these people's surprise that this had happened after the fact. My question to you is, you were a government employee, and you work with a lot of military people.
Yes.
And I have to believe that most of these people are good people.
They are.
Yeah. And my point is, like, well, where are they now? And how do they sleep? And how do they keep silent over this whole thing? There's got to be thousands of people out there who know almost as much as you do.
Yes. Well, first off, you're talking about what's called OPSEC, operational security, in a highly compartmented black operation. And you don't get to be a black operator at that level unless you follow orders, no matter what. And you know that if you talk, you are dead, and maybe your family's dead too. And then, on the other hand, people say, well, how could they keep it secret? They kept the Manhattan Project secret with far more people than that, number one. Number two, how could my government do this? They did it at Pearl Harbor, the original Pearl Harbor. That's why they wanted a new Pearl Harbor, if you really know the history of Pearl Harbor. Pearl Harbor, if you read the book by Stinnett, Day of Deceit, be sure and get the most up-to-date edition of Day of Deceit, and in particular in the back, because as he was about to publish Day of Deceit, the first edition, the National Archives, he had done an FOIA request to the National Archives for proof that Roosevelt and Churchill and the high command in the Navy knew that the attack at Pearl Harbor was coming. Now, in that case, there was a real enemy, but that attack was protected, and the high asset carriers were moved out of Pearl Harbor. The others were ordered to remain there as sitting ducks, the Arizona and the other ships. And Admiral Kimmel, who was the chief admiral at Pearl Harbor, was explicitly, the orders were given not to tell him of the intelligence that was already known from breaking the Purple Code and the magic machines. So we know that Pearl Harbor, like the Reichstag fire, if you will, was a protected attack by an enemy that was desired to happen for larger geopolitical goals. And so was 9/11.
Yeah, but I see that perhaps the difference in Pearl Harbor is that, you know, we were led to believe that we have a common enemy, being the, you know, yes, the Japanese and the Nazi.
It was a true enemy.
Yeah, it was a true enemy. And whereas 9/11, we really want to create fear to make this fictitious enemy so we can keep pouring money into this whole machine.
Well, 9/11, after 9/11, what we have done in the name of the 9/11 lie has created a real enemy. It didn't exist before, I don't believe.
Yeah, and, yes. And then, you know, I guess the point is, the result is the American people losing our civil liberties.
Yes.
You know, we created this Gestapo-like organization.
Homeland Security Department.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So everybody is seeing the effect of what happened.
Correct.
You know, with 9/11. So these guys, these friends of yours,
they're not my friends.
Well, I mean, they...
Sorry.
Well,
shouldn't
what
that
I mean
be
is
obvious?
You've got to have friends in there who are losing sleep over this still. You know,
no, they're not my friends, and I don't know anyone close. I've never signed any classification agreement ever. I would never do that. I was a public journalist. No, they're not my friends.
Well, there's got to be a lot of people who has conscience that would be still.
There are people with consciences who have spoken to me. I've given you the quotes from many of them at a very high level. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, for heaven's sakes, has gone public with information that proves the official story is a lie. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Go ahead.
The way the plane came in, besides how far it got or close to the building, it flew over a highway, a major highway. Weren't there people who saw what kind of plane it was who were traveling on the highway at that time? And of course, if the, you know, your point, if there are explosions further in the building or other kinds of explosions, to get the plane to line up with what, excuse me, with where that would happen, would take a very good pilot to do that. And so the question I would have is, or two, didn't people see this plane who are driving on the highway, what it looked like? And what's said about how a terrorist pilot could line up and even fly into the Pentagon that way?
Well, I've just shown you that a terrorist pilot did not fly into the Pentagon, number one. Number two, the official story path is not the way the plane came. And it wasn't Flight 77 to begin with. It was a white plane that was formed and painted to simulate an American Airlines plane. And yes, many witnesses did see it, and after the official story was put out, assumed that it was Flight 77. Yes.
You showed, during your presentation, you showed a photograph of a thermite explosion after the impact, and I just wondered if
a possible thermite. It was an explosion. It's possible thermite.
Okay. I wondered if you knew what the source was and whether or not there's more CATV photographs of the actual incident available.
Right. There are only two videotapes that the government claims exist at all, and that's under oath by the FBI analyst who looked at all 85 that the FBI says they have. There are only two, and they were almost identical videotapes from the two outside cameras, from the security cameras, and all they show is an explosion. They do not show a plane. That is the only video. The only photograph of the explosion we have is that one photograph that I showed you that appears to be an explosion. It may or may not be the same explosion. It probably is, but we don't know for sure.
You've shown who the people are that you believe are actually pulling the trigger on all of this. The question is, who is behind these people and what's their ultimate goal? Does this work its way all the way into a one world government business and all that?
Mm-hmm. I think at the beginning I made clear who I think is behind it. It is the signatories of the Project for a New American Century, and in turn behind them are people like the Rockefellers, the Council on Foreign Relations. The World Trade Center towers were built and owned by the Rockefellers, and I believe that they were built to be brought down. And Rockefeller, David Rockefeller himself, was asked. You can see it, I believe that you can actually see it on a video, but if not, certainly the quote, it's a public quote. He was asked, he said words to the effect, I've been accused of wanting a one world government and being willing to do anything to get it. And then after some more verbiage, he said, well, if that's what I'm accused of, I'm proud to say that it's true. Words to that effect. This was necessary, I believe, in order to justify, after the fall of the Soviet Union, after the fall of the wall, and when they were allegedly a unipolar power before the rise of China and other, as they call them, peer competitors or potential adversaries in the military, I believe that was the time that the people behind the Project for a New American Century, and they even say so, that they believe that they should strike while the iron was hot, as it were, and have some kind of a pretext, a new Pearl Harbor, to justify an American century. It was called Project for a New American Century, to have a global domination.
Yeah, I've thought ever since about a week after 9/11 happened that it was an inside job, and I certainly agree with you on that. And I think it was done in order to get us ready for protracted war in the Middle East, which we've had now. We've been Afghanistan for 12 years now, and now they're thinking about it. We will get out soon. Everybody's going to go back to sleep and say everything was fine. But the thing is, sometimes it is necessary to go to war, and it's very hard to get the public of this country to do that, which is why...
That's why Pearl Harbor was protected.
They let Pearl Harbor happen.
Yes.
So that we
facilitated
go to war.
Pearl Harbor to happen.
And they can manufacture this Tonkin Gulf incident to get us into Vietnam.
Yes.
Now, after Vietnam, nobody wanted to even hear about war anymore.
Right.
But now after 9/11, people were hot. Let's go get those bastards.
But that was the whole point.
Okay, but the thing is, okay, so why is all this being done? And one thing that's not mentioned very often is that there's one little habit we have in this country called driving around in cars, which is using something like 30% of the world's oil production. We're only 4% of the world's population. How do we get away with that? By terrorizing everybody else into letting us have it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what I think is going on. So I'd like you to comment on that.
Well, Michael Rupert's book, Crossing the Rubicon, would be what I would recommend that you read on precisely that. By the way, chapters 19 and 20 on the war games are based upon my work, for which he credits me as coming up with a holy grail of 9/11 research, that the realization that the war games and emergency response exercises on 9/11 were on hijack scenarios. That's a very important book, but the vast majority of the book, of course, is his proposal that the powers that be in the United States and NATO countries, especially Britain, saw or believed that peak oil was coming, and if it hadn't already come. It's not clear that it has come, but if they believed that it had come, that they wanted to be in a position with troops on the ground in the Middle East to control the movement of fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. Over here.
These flights, you know, I didn't believe until last year that these flights were not real. Mm-hmm. And I've become convinced in the last year that these flights have been fake. Last year, there was Professor Fetzer,
yes,
who came
Jim
to
Fetzer.
Town. Yeah, and he was threatened when he was going to give his presentation.
Yeah.
And they had to put it in a little church in U District.
Yes, I remember, just before the Vancouver hearings.
For a small mm-hmm. thing. And he has come out with this theory, and he has, because I was suspicious of it from the beginning, because how do these planes, when you see it in the film, even on the World Trade Center buildings, how do these planes cut through the World Trade Center, which is concrete, like butter?
Well, it didn't. Right. I've interviewed, I want to go on record that right. I have a completely different point of view than Professor Fetzer on the World Trade Center towers. There was at least the plane, a real plane, that impacted World Trade Center 2. I've interviewed witnesses who were physically on the ground, on the sidewalk,
yes.
saw it go over, hit,
yes.
and pieces of the plane almost
yes.
killed them.
Yes.
So just right. because you have proof that some of the videotapes of World Trade Center impacts were faked in whole or in part, tells you nothing about what happened there.
Right.
It doesn't rule out a plane mm-hmm. impact at all. Okay, two more questions.
Okay, you had the point of following the money, right? And that like $3.5 trillion was missing?
2.3.
Okay, whatever. A lot of money.
Uh-huh.
What happened
to that? Yeah, it adds up.
Okay, and I get that, you know, the people who were auditing that were blown up, but he admitted the money was gone, right? What happened about that?
No, they said they couldn't account for it.
Well, okay, they couldn't
yeah.
account for it, so that just disappeared when they
blew
up the accounting?
Well, it went into, okay, I address that very in great detail in my forthcoming book, which will have the same title as this presentation, Behind the Smoke Curtain. I address it in detail, and it's a complicated question. But one of the things that I have discovered is that very often the Naval Command Center, which was, I mean, one of the witnesses there, an exact quote was that this looked like a bombed out office. Okay, and according to the official story, sole survivor of the Naval Command Center, which is 2 and 3 rings in, Kevin Schaefer, he stated that the explosion went off there at precisely 9:43. According to the official Pentagon building performance report, the alleged Flight 77 hit at 9:37 and 46 seconds, almost 9:38, and had gone completely through the building, through the Naval Command Center in less than 1 second. So by 9:37 and 47 seconds. So you've got many, many minutes before Kevin Schaefer says a bomb. He doesn't say bomb, but he says there was an explosion there, and it was described as a bombed out office space. So why is that important? It's important because I've learned that the Naval Command Center was not only almost certainly part of Able Danger, which was tracking the hijackers prior to 9/11, almost a year and a half, including 3 of the 4 cells that were allegedly involved. They had records of that there. Those records were destroyed of not only that, but I learned that there's something called the Black Eagle Fund that was allegedly $240 billion that was controlled by the Central Intelligence Agency and almost certainly by George Bush Sr. himself, that had been used to sabotage the Soviet Union secretly, economically sabotage the Soviet Union, which was one of the main reasons that it fell, and not because of Osama bin Laden, who was our own CIA asset in Afghanistan. And that those records, records of that were actually held in the Naval Command Center also.
My question is, what is your opinion of the National Defense Authorization Act, and what is your prediction for the civil liberties in the United States?
What is my opinion of the National Defense Authorization Act? Well, I think you're talking about the provision of the national, the provisions, I think there are two of the National Defense Authorization Act, NDAA, which has just been approved by Congress, that effectively the president is presuming to himself the authority to kidnap, basically, an American citizen anywhere in the world, including in the United States, hold them without trial, without an attorney, indefinitely, torture them, and even kill them. All constitutionally. This is, of course, absurd. And it needs to go to the Supreme Court, but only after the Supreme Court hopefully has a better mix of progressive versus conservative justices. Thank you.